Hey y'all, hey. Welcome everybody. Happy Friday. It is Friday. Welcome y'all to the speakeasy. Can I have a libation, please? I got everything here. I'm kind of a little disoriented a little bit. Y'all show some love to my moderators, Evelyn, Love Jones. Thank you. I see you are a family and bikini body challenge. Thank you again yesterday for yesterday to those who sent cash apps for Love Jones' birthday. That was Black Diamond and Hey Mimi. Thank you, thank you. I appreciate you. And oh Lord, my book done jumped up. Hold on. Wait. Child, listen. Let me make sure. Hey. I am on Instagram. Yes. Black Diamond and Hey Mimi. Yes, God. All right. Thank you for showing her birthday love. Y'all listen. Okay. All right. So I appreciate y'all. And thank you guys for showing them some virtual love today in the chat. Y'all, please make sure you like my video on your way in. It is the proper behavior. Oh, that's good. All right, so listen. Before we get started, let me speak to you guys. Foxy Woxy was the first in the building, son. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Hey, Love Jones. Happy day after your birthday, friend. Welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey, Dana Wayna. Welcome, lovey. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you guys. Hey, Evelyn. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Let me see who else. Hey, Choco Chip. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Mimi. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, happy all day with your happy all day ass. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. You just got the notification. Y'all, listen, I was a little late. Hey, mother. Welcome, Black Diamond. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, so listen, y'all. We are going to do chapters 5 through 10. And then perhaps, because I thought I was going to have something ready for y'all. I did not. And y'all haven't been to sleep. I have been up trying to get things in order. See how that worked out, right? So perhaps after some sleep. But I'll come back after this and we'll chat it up a little bit because I had an interesting conversation with a young lady last night that I would like to share with you guys. Yes. If I can stay awake, I'll come back and we'll chop it up a little bit. But for those of you that are here, hey y'all, hey. Thank y'all for supporting my little janky podcast. And yes, we have our community wall. If you have not seen it, go over there and have a gander and leave me a comment. I know I still have a lot more people to respond to, so I don't want y'all feeling no type of way talking about some. I left a whole comment and she ain't even say thank you or nothing. I still have to go and respond to the comments. I still have to go and do that. Yes, Love Jones said, thank you so very much for the birthday love yesterday at Hey Mimi. And yes, and she thanked Mother yesterday. She did that already. All right, so I'm gonna get around to leaving responses, okay? So don't nobody get all off in their feelings. So thank you to the people in the chat. Hey, Kim Bird, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. So listen. Don't feel no type of way. I'm gonna get to the comments, okay? So let's get started with chapters 5 through 10. And then that way I can still be awake, okay? And come back to y'all a little bit later about this conversation that I had, y'all. It was most enlightening. All right. So I hope everybody had a good Friday. And looking forward to an excellent weekend. Again, please make sure you like the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't, share it on your social media, participate in the chat box conversation, right? Or if you're on the replay, for all y'all that are on the replay, please leave a comment, like, share, and subscribe. Yes. All right. And so for those of y'all that are here, let's get into it. All right. So, chapter 5. Must be in my casket now. I'm still. I'm laid out on my back. Wait, let me make sure my notifications is off, child, because you know people loves to call. Let me see. Hold on. I don't know how to put that. I don't know what comment you put. Oh, there you go. Okay. Hey y'all. Hey, Miss Evelyn says hello. However, she's driving, so she won't be able to chat, but she's listening. All right, there you go. I'm like, what? Okay, there we go. All right, now let me turn this ring off, child, because listen, people love to call you as soon as you start doing something. All right, listen, y'all know this is a janky ass podcast. We do it how we do it over here. All right. All right, so I'm laid out on my back. My face and neck are numb, paralyzed even. The back of my head feels mushy. I'm cold, no longer a ball of heat. I'm stiff, feeling no space on my left or right, over my head or beneath my feet. I don't know if my limbs are all swelling or if the casket is shrinking. I can hear my own ribs cracking. I don't know if I'm still blind or if this is just the darkest darkness I ever saw. My eyes are glued closed. I can't scream when I get furious. Someone stitched my lips shut. I feel something tiny crawling on me, or maybe I'm imagining it. I'm outraged that I can still imagine. If I'm in my casket, blind, deaf, and dumb, why isn't my mind shut off? I want it shut off completely. Who would ever want to be buried deep in the cold, dark earth while being 100% aware? Not me, but that's what I am now. Nothing else besides thoughts and imaginings. I was never a daydreaming, fragile, actionless, vulnerable bitch. Now the tiniest bugs and worms and insects and whatever else creeps and crawls below the earth are looking at me like I'm food. On lockup, we had bitches who we treated like food. No one dared to treat me that way. I'm thinking now, the whole rest in peace thing is a sham. I'm dead, but definitely not resting and definitely not in peace. I began to think about people who I knew who got dead in my lifetime. One of my closest, tightest Brooklyn Fly girls from way back when we used to say shit like Fly Girls was named Neek. We were best friends before I ever met Natalie. Neek was a crazy cutie, a goody two-shoes girl who loved school and was a cheerleader. Because we were both dimes, even though we were extremely different from one another, our looks and mutual popularity pushed and held us together. Only murder could separate us, and it did. Neek was killed by her own moms, who believed that Neek was fucking her man. Neek wasn't. Neek wasn't fucking nobody, and everybody except the donkeys know that fucking and raping ain't the same damn thing. The night before her moms killed her, I found out from Meek that her mama's boyfriend was all the time chasing and cornering her, trying to touch, feel, and fuck Meek, even though she said no, hated him, and fought back. Her mom stays stuck on stupid, but I think the crazy bitch was just pretending. She would tell Neek to try and get along with him, even though he was not her real father. She would be telling Neek how nice he was and how good he was to her. She even said if it wasn't for him, their lights would have been cut off because she couldn't afford to pay all of the bills on her own. I think she was on the low trying to convince her daughter that since the asshole was paying a few essential bills, why not overlook the situation? But even she couldn't take her own advice. She must have caught him in the act of lusting or violating Meek. So she murked her own 14 years young daughter. I was also 14 when I lost my fly ass best friend. The Friday after Neek's murder, me, Natalie, Simone, Reese, Zakia, Tashi, and Asia all went to school to rep for Neek. We had the wildest, illest rest in peace rally our high school ever had. We made the whole student body stand up for Neek. We made the cheerleaders cheer for her, the band play for her, the drumline drum for her, and the thugs to feel for her on that day. Now, I know it's all bullshit. I'm wondering if Neek is still laying in her casket umpteen years later, still getting violated by creepy crawly things, same as when she was alive, because now that she's been dead for years, she can't move and her legs and arms are swollen and her casket is shrinking and her ribs are cracking and the back of her head is disintegrating, same as mine. Before my death, this was my point to the prison chaplain, who, along with the prison social worker and the prison psyche, were all the biggest frauds. Furthermore, they existed not to cure or correct or inspire us. They were not qualified to do any of that anyway. They were a trio of broken down bitches barely holding their own lives together, strategically placed and meagerly paid to take out their misery on the prisoner bitches who they stupidly thought were beneath them. Point blank, they were there to interrupt the gangs, crews, cliques, and families we formed to protect and provide for ourselves instead of obeying any of the bullshit they was all peddling that. Put together, all added up to nothing. I was one prisoner who they couldn't access. I was one who didn't ever and never ever would confess or confide in them. When they talked, I'd think of other things, listen to music in my mind. I'd give them the glare of the blank stare and the torture of silence. They said I needed an exorcism, whatever the fuck that is. They couldn't send me to church by force, so they tugged at my team. They even targeted my cellmate, a bitch named Veronica. She wasn't one of my original Brooklyn crew. She was from Queens, claiming Queens Bridge. That was a reputable hood on my hood map, but wasn't the reason I put her on. I put her on with my team because me and Veronica was locked up in the same small cell, sitting on the same toilet, spitting in the same sink. She was watching, even if she pretended not to be watching me. She could clock my movements, intercept or read my kites and letters, and count my contraband. I jumped her into the gang so she would understand our routine, participate when we break in the rules, and maintain the confidence of the crew because of the threat that she would also be held responsible if we got caught doing the shit we do. Next thing I know, Simone de Beast says she saw Veronica coming out of Chaplain Kaplan's office. She left it up to me to find out what my cellmate was doing in there, what Chaplain was asking her, what Veronica was saying, and who she was telling on. Heard you was chopping it up with Chap, I said casually. It was lights out and we was both laid out in our bunks. Something like that. I didn't say nothing in case that's why you're asking about it, Veronica denied instantly. Nah, I know you ain't no snitch. You know better, I said softly. So what about it then? Veronica turned the question back on me. Chap's the one I don't trust. What did she ask you? She was doing her job, talking about Jesus and saving my soul. Why you was listening to that shit? I asked her. I'm doing 15, same as you. That's a long time. I'm scoping out the benefits. Then she added, Chaplain got a jar of caramels. I heard another mate talking about it. She was like, if you listen to Chaplain's Jesus stories, Chap will let you chew her caramels. Veronica said, then laughed. Chap got you open with a piece of candy, I said, letting Veronica hear how ridiculous she sounded. So all you did was listen, I asked, still measuring the threat. Yeah, I figured if she got caramel, she got some other shit in her stash. So I listened a long time. And what did you get out of it? I pushed. Veronica went silent for some seconds. Chap has a few steaks in her stash. I ain't taste nothing that good in a while. She threw butter on her beef. I got hooked. After I started chowing down while listening to what Chaplin was saying, it all started to make sense to me. She was talking about sins in a slick way, like not asking me about confessing my sins, but just telling me about what sins are, like lying, cheating, stealing, murdering, covering other people's stuff. I'm sorry, coveting other people's stuff. Having sex without being married, sleeping with someone's husband or wife, shit like that. She was telling me how to confess, pray, and apologize to the Lord for my sins and say certain prayers, and then I'll receive blessings from doing that. That bitch is lying, I said swiftly. First of all, me and you is both serving mandatory minimums. Do you know what the word mandatory means? It means that that shit is non-negotiable, no matter what you do in here on the inside, even if you kiss the warden's ass and the chaplain's ass and the social worker's ass and the psych's ass and all the CO's asses. You ain't getting out till you hit 15 years time served. You can pray to the warden, the judge, the jury, Jesus, whoever. You ain't getting out no earlier than 15. Don't let her run that psych on you. True that. But Chaplin was talking about if human beings don't give our lives to Jesus and apologize to the Lord for our sins and stop living sinfully, the only place our souls will go is to hell. Veronica sounded like she was going for Chap's talk. That's pimp talk, I told Veronica. Chap's a pimp and so is Jesus. Hell, even a pimp on the street only demands that you give him some of the money you pull in while working your body. Jesus demands that you give your life to him. Check it out. Chaplin stole some steaks from the staff cafe. She fed it to you, an inmate. Both things, stealing and contraband, is illegal. She's a lying bitch who pretends everybody else should tell on themselves. She don't tell on herself. Chap even got a girlfriend. You know C.O. Baker, the one with the close-cropped boy haircut who works in the other building, but we see her on the yard? Her and Chap are lovers. So what? Veronica said passionately. I agree. So fucking what? No big deal, right? I was about to show her. A lot of chicks on lock got their girl lovers. You know why? Because that's what they want to do. That's who they picked, and that's their choice, right? I asked. Hell yeah, that's right, Veronica agreed. But meanwhile, Chap doesn't want to let you do what you want to do. Choose what you want to choose. Chill with who you want to chill with. Chap says you got to confess your sins and stop, or else you going to hell. But Chap ain't confessing her sins. And even if she was, she damn sure ain't stopping her stealing, smuggling, or her relationship with C.O. Baker, who I know through the vine is actually married with some other woman. All that shit is a sin, even according to Chap, but not according to me. So what's up with that? And if there really is a hell and Chap knows she's going there because she's still sinning and not stopping, it must not be too bad of a place to go. Or she must not really believe in what she's saying in the first place. I wrapped up my campaign to snatch back my girl Veronica so she wouldn't break our crew or eventually flip and betray us. I never thought about it from that angle, Veronica said after a long pause. But according to Chap, Jesus died for all our sins. Let's say he did. Whoever he is anyway. I don't trust people I can't see, didn't grow up with, ain't from the same hood, or at least from the same circumstance. But let's say he dies so we can sin, which sounds like mean pimp gang. Then why is Chap sweating you then? Jesus threw away his life, washed your sins away, hers and everybody else's. That means everybody is free to do whatever the fuck we want to do. Jesus, whoever that is, took the fall for everybody. That's what Chap said. Chap's still doing what she wants to do, even though she knows she's sinning. So we all, even Steven. If everybody minds their own fucking business and does whatever the fuck they want to do and don't try to judge, block, stop, or control anybody else's life or choices, it's all good, right? I could see in her eyes that my reasoning was working on her. To seal it, I asked her, so, who you supposed to be praying to if Jesus is dead? I didn't ask Chapman all that, Veronica said, suddenly sounding aggravated. Now you won't have to. There's nobody to pray to. Nobody is listening. Don't you think Chap been praying, asking dead Jesus for a better job than this fucked up place? Even if somebody was listening, mandatory means exactly what it means. Besides, Chaplin is right in here with us, New York State Prison. She ain't no different except she got a fucking jar of caramels and stolen steaks, and we got commissary and gotta pay for what we want. We work in here. She works in here. Except she gets a little itty-bitty paycheck. So the difference between her and us is about $300 a week. You gonna bow down to a bitch who every other word out of her mouth is a fraud game, who in 1 week only brings home $300? Veronica, you locked up for hustling, making $300 every 3 fucking seconds. Case closed. I won her over. I could feel it. Veronica never answered me that night. I know she wasn't sleeping. The next day, when we had 15 minutes to shoot the shit, our girl crew was talking. Simone had told everybody about Veronica's trip to the chaplain. Asia said to all of us, if Veronica wants to start going to church and chilling with the chaplain, leave her ass alone. It ain't got nothing to do with us. Most of the hustlers and even the rappers who we knew and love, I'm sorry, who we know and love, be rocking a Jesus piece. It don't mean nothing. It don't stop shit from happening. When I was on my knees sucking Rojo's dick, that diamond-flooded crucifix was swinging side to side right above my head. He wasn't thinking about Jesus, his wife, or his kids. That nigga was just moaning like a bitch. We all started cracking up, even Veronica. Next day, she was back to confidently doing what we do with us. My casket plus my memory of my girls caused me to miss lockup, which I never thought was possible to miss. Back in Brooklyn, I was used to living with my Santiago family and running with my hood friends. When Santiago moved us to our Long Island mansion, I spent all my time trying to get back to my Brooklyn hood, my bitches, and my niggas. On lockup, I got ganged up eventually and was used to rolling in a crew of my girls. Even when planning my release after 15 years, I had thought to live in the same house with my crew. That's why this casket shit is bullshit to me. Why am I alone? If hell really exists, which I never really thought about unless some sucker from the group home or the prison brought it up. Same as I don't believe in the boogeyman or ghosts or anything like that. Same as I love the haunted house and horror flicks, because that shit is all just entertaining bullshit to me that could be enjoyed and laughed at after having a few blunts and beers. And if this is hell and I'm in right now, why ain't the place packed? Where is everybody else? I'm game for hell as long as I'm not the only one in it. If this is hell, bring all of the other motherfucking dead sinners so we can have a party. I can only exist where the action is at. And that's the end of chapter 5. All right. So, chapter 6. It can't be only me here, I thought, but it was. It could have been 6 seconds or 6 minutes or 6 hours or 6 days or 6 weeks or 6 months or 6 years after my death. I could not tell how much time had passed. All I know is what's happening to me at the moment. I'm no longer laying flat in my casket. I'm sitting, same as I would be sitting back on my Brooklyn block on a bench or a stoop. Really, though, it feels like I'm sitting on a curb close to the open sewer. The stench is like a beating. A continuous foul smell that only changes from stinky to the stinkiest. The odor is so foul that even after I suspected that the smell might be coming from my unwashed, rotting body, I could not confirm it. Must be the stench is traveling in waves of steam coming up from the sewer. I want to get up and walk away from the smell like any sensible bitch would, but my legs cannot move. It's dark, completely black. There has been no sunshine here or even one speck of light, not even artificial light. Like from a light bulb. That meant there are no days and no seasons. There is no sunrise and no sunset. I could say it's like nighttime all of the time where I am now. Even that would be a lie, though. Excuse me. Down here, there is no moon and no moonshine and not one single star. So it is unlike nighttime because there is no night shine. Instead of the rotating earth, and the alternation of days and nights, instead of a moving sky or clouds or even rain, snow or hail, thunder or lightning, there is none of that, just deep blackness. There is only the threat of the unexpected. The stench is the only permanent thing. Could be 6 months worth of odor from my period blood, my poop, my urine, and my sweat combined. Even the thought of that stinks. The odor randomly intensifies, ranging from high to higher to the highest foulness. As though it is being controlled, like how the knob on the stovetop can lessen or increase the degree of a flame. There is no flame to be seen, though, because that would be a form of light and would upset the theme here. But at certain intervals, a heat rushes beneath me that causes me to want to leap up, yet I cannot. It's like here where I am, it would be cold as a freezer, then suddenly it would feel like someone was frying my ass as it set out on the curb. And the soles of my feet as they rested on the street. I'd rather whoever runs this place to decide on one temperature and stick to it. Hang on, you guys, let me wet my whistle. There's no music here. I ain't heard a jam or joint in I don't know how long, but there are plenty of strange sounds at varying volumes. Some soft, like the hissing that comes and stays for what seems like a long while. It is the hissing that makes my skin crawl. Then suddenly it disappears, only to be replaced by the sound of cracking. Like 99 niggas cracking their knuckles at the same time. Oh my God, if that ain't enough, next it's the high volume sound of bones breaking and the screaming that follows the breaking. Sounds like a whole city of screamers, as though all of the boroughs of New York, including Brooklyn, the Bronx, Manhattan, Queens, and Staten Island, more than 8 million people, are screaming at one time. The screaming sound is the weirdest to me because I am the only one here. When it comes around, I try to ignore it, even though it is too loud and impossible to ignore. I just use my determination, go inside of my own thoughts, and think about some other shit that I prefer. Once the screams cease, I'll hear something like grinding. It is kind of like the sound of that annoying drill that the dentist uses. It's like a million people getting dental work done at the same time. That shit is annoying and even harder to ignore. Someone was trying to break me, I know, but Winter Santiago is not easily broken. Number one, I'm not afraid of the dark. Number two, I don't like the noise, but I've heard the sound of 100 bitches banging on their cell doors at the same time. Number three, I've heard screaming when the task force forces their way down the tiers and into each prison cell and starts attacking chicks with some trumped up bullshit reason. Excuse me. Number four, I remember when the prison toilet system failed, and instead of all of our shit getting flushed down, it squirted up and into our faces, then flooded our cells. So I'm well familiar with overwhelming stench. Number five, I've heard Simone sharpening chicken bones by dragging each bone back and forth on the cement wall till they were each good enough to stab or puncture somebody who wouldn't bow down to our crew. When it wasn't bones she was sharpening, it would be anything that could be continuously scraped and grinded until it was razor sharp so that she could sell it to some other bitch who wasn't one of our enemies, wasn't one of our crew either, but was simply a customer who needed to defend herself, which was an everyday thing. As for number six, the hissing, I'm not accustomed to the hissing. If I could choose to dead one sound, that would be it. Sounded like 600 jealous bitches whispering at the same time about someone whose look or style they simply couldn't match or touch or tolerate. Come to think of it, I have heard that envy-inspired whispering, hissing sound before plenty of times. How long you just gonna sit there? I heard a sexy-sounding male voice say. It had the rhythm and the accent and cockiness of a New York dweller. It was the next unexpected thing happening in this unknown place at this very moment. Mind your fucking business, I replied, all matter of fact. Hide your fangs, honey. Nobody down here shows all of the cards they are holding when the game is just getting started. Whatever, I rejected his talk with that one word. What's your name? He asked me. Don't ask me shit, I told him. Winter's very angry for a dead girl. I'm sorry. She said, "Don't ask me shit." I don't know why that's tickling me, but it is. I'm sorry. Okay. Oh, God. This child don't even know where she is, and she already acted crazy. I'm sorry. All right. Find out if I got what you need before you dismiss me, he said calmly. I know you don't, I said dryly. Nigga, you got a palace, a glass shower, water that actually makes me wet, a king-size bed, silk sheets, and a whip with navigation to drive me out of this disgusting dark place, which I knew he didn't, otherwise he wouldn't be here. He laughed. You're real pretty, he said, dragging out the word real like it wasn't a short one-syllable word. But I see you're the tenacious, tough type, like to play hard to get. Make a nigga prove himself to you about 66 times, and then still, that ain't enough. Can you see me? I asked. I was excited. Him saying and knowing how pretty I am piqued my interest. Pretty eyes and pretty dark eyelashes, pretty skin and beautiful hair, sexy lips and sexy body curves. I see you clearly, he said calmly. I especially love the scar. Makes you stand out. I never trust a bitch who doesn't have a few cuts and scrapes. It means she never lived, never did nothing real. I felt myself opening, but immediately closed down on him. He's suspicious. I thought he was trying to gas me. Don't go for it, Winter, I told myself. What am I wearing then? I asked him in a tone that was all doubt. Easy question, he said. You're the only one down here wearing white, he said strangely. I didn't see nobody down here at all before he showed up, so what the fuck was he talking about? Mink and the python, he said. I was caught off guard. I couldn't feel or see my mink or my red boots. I couldn't see myself. I couldn't even see him. But I was starting to like that he could see me, that he acknowledged my look and style and perfection. On top of that, his presence confirmed that it was not me stinking. It must be this atmosphere, because no nigga is going to pull up and kick it to a bitch that smell like trash mixed with old rotting pussy. Jesus. What do you want? I asked him with less stress in my voice. That's the question I'm supposed to ask you, he said confidently. What you selling? I asked, knowing full well ain't shit free. Exactly what you want and need, he said, then added, things that you need to have down here that money can't buy. You gotta just know somebody who knows somebody, he said, sounding like an old trick daddy joint. Oh, wow. How would you know what I want and need? Let me take a stab at it, he said. You need light. And as soon as he said that, a 6-foot flame shot up across from me that caused me to lean back. I was so freaking happy to see something, anything. But I played it cool while I let my eyes adjust to the brilliant flame so I could use it to check and see exactly what he looked like. Could be his voice's sexy masculinity, but he was not. I wasn't going to just let some fat, bald, old, short, pussy guy push up on me in the dark and expect me to flow with it just because he made a fire. The red flame turned blue. The blue flame emitted black smoke. Out of the smoke walked a 6-foot tall, more than handsome black beauty, a chiseled man who flicked a flame out of his muscular left shoulder. It fell to the ground and became a lamp that allowed me to look him over even more carefully. I surveyed him with my game face on. All that time sitting in darkness, I had not needed my game face. Now it was on and popping, even though I didn't visibly react. Stand up, he said, extending his hand. I didn't give him my hand. I didn't want him to know my hand. My handicap. My legs didn't move anymore, so I remained seated. Suddenly, the entire black atmosphere, minus the flame lamp, turned green. I was so accustomed to the blackness that I stared for what I guess was a minute at the green, gas-like substance replacing the black. I was thinking, if it's not blacker than night here, then it's supposed to be either bright like sunlight or blue like the sky. I recall the sun in the sky. It had not faded from my memory. So the now green backdrop threw me off. To break my stare, he leaned in and grazed my legs with his fingertips. Instantly, I could feel them. Yes, I can feel both of my legs. I extended my hand. When our fingers interlocked, he pulled me up into him as smoothly as though I had not been sitting there paralyzed for 6 months or 6 years. And you need a man, not just any man. You need me, he said. I could feel my pussy pump even though he was spitting a corny movie line. Let's go, he said. Of course I'm game to get the fuck out of here no matter where we going next, long as it wasn't here. We started running hand in hand. I was thrilled that my thighs were moving and I could feel my feet hitting the pavement. I was even more excited to have a companion. I don't trust him, but he gave me the gift of light and made my legs work, so fuck it. I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt. Suddenly, a strong wind of the prettiest perfume I ever smelled came breezing through like a powerful hurricane that made it more difficult for us to run. It pushed us both back a bit. The expensive and enticing scent completely replaced the foul, severe sewer odor. As we ran against the force of the perfume wind, a sexy lavender sky appeared overhead. So sexy, I stopped to watch. He pulled my hand and said, "Don't stop if you want to ever get out of here." But I had to stop. I haven't seen colors in what felt like 100 years. The lavender sky opened up and began spilling some sparkling stars that were like diamond raindrops. The stars formed into the outline of a feminine figure. I was caught up by the design of it all. Then the unexpected happened. Although I shouldn't have been surprised, I am. Come on, don't pay her no mind. She's my ex, he said, about the 16 years young, vibrant dime when she walked out of the diamond ring. How can I ignore a bitch made up of stars? That's some new shit. Besides, she looked like me at 16. I could see that Santiago beauty blood running all in her. Had me confounded. Was she Mercedes or Lexi? No. Why would any of them be down here? Maybe one of them did die. That's why the two midnight sons were fighting over the only twin left alive. But if one of the Santiago twins had died, wouldn't I know it? I am their sister, so of course I would know. Unless they were planning to tell me after my prison release to keep me from feeling pissy going into my big reality show debut. Yup, that's what happened, I convinced myself. I knew that a bitch like me who did more than a decade bid only really had word of mouth, gossip, and rumor from the streets to rely on. No details about what was actually going on with my own bloodline behind closed doors, except for Santiago, who was locked, same as me. She's the police. Don't be fooled by her. She fooled me one time, he warned. He didn't have to tell me twice. We ran off for what felt like a long distance. He jumped into a black Jaguar. I heard a female voice calling me back. It wouldn't have mattered to me none. The police always say some shit like, it's the police, freeze. But in this case, the powerful feminine voice had called out only one word, winter. The volume and intensity of her voice and the now repetition of my name and just the fact that she even knew my name sparked my curiosity, although it couldn't and didn't stop me from jumping in. He pulled off. Since the Jag windows were tinted, I instinctively turned to look out of the rear. I still couldn't see anything. The atmosphere had turned completely black again. I could hear whipping winds that howled like a wind wolf. The winds were so forceful that they rocked the ride from side to side, even though it was speeding forward. He didn't react to the rocking or the darkness or the deafening wind whip sounds. Instead, he was leaning back in his driver's seat like a real hustler, riding dirty, chilling so hard as if it was just another day in his neighborhood. He turned on the radio without reaching. Music, finally. It was the provocative and arousing instrumental track to the song When Doves Cry by Prince. I pictured him in my mind. Prince was not the style of man I would want to fuck. Child, I don't know why. But he is king of those guitar strings. Furthermore, he is hands down definitely one of the rare ones who got that thing. You trying to burn a hole into the side of my face? He suddenly asked me. I must have been staring. I was digging his carved up arm and the way his strong hand held the steering wheel. Of course I was checking him out thoroughly and examining his whip. Couldn't believe he had the new joint. I had read about the Jaguar XJ. The timing caught my attention. Both me and the car released in 2010. The dash was mean and the controls were embedded in his steering. He's shifting gears smoothly while enjoying the sounds. As Prince's music was ending, he lowered the volume with the press of his thumb while reclining. The high speed of the ride decreased and soon we came to a smooth stop. We were sitting there in the blackness. I heard the radio jock say, and this cut is by the Scissor Sisters. It's titled, I Can't Decide. I never heard of them. How could the DJ try and follow up some Prince with some unknown performers singing an unknown song? My place is down this hill. Before I downshift, I want to make sure you want to be with me. If not, you can get out, he said calmly. But I thought it was strange. It was total blackness outside. Why would I get out? Where would I go? And without him, would my legs go back to being paralyzed after his touch has caused them to feel alive and move properly? Nigga, what? I said, instead of telling him the thoughts in my mind. When I ride with a nigga, I ride with a nigga, I confirmed. He leaned my way, reached up, and pulled down my seatbelt, then locked it into place. His gesture got me feeling even more open. That's what I thought, he said, smiling some. But it's good to double check. When the action starts, I don't want you pretending that I forced you, he said. I don't let nobody force me, I said. That's not the type of bitch I am. So, you ready to handle me, he said, smiling again. He knew his teeth were perfect and his smile convincing. I don't really know you like that, but I handle whatever comes to me, I said in my first sexy tone. All you need to know about me, he said, is my stroke is strong and my dick is longer than my tail. The Jaguar dropped, angled, and they had sped downhill like a rocket instead of a car. My heart was racing. It felt good, reminding me of the drop of the King Dakar roller coaster at Great Adventure. Child, I know that drop. Yes, God. When I was teen young, I'd choose the fastest, steepest, wildest drop roller coaster and ride it repeatedly the whole day. My cousins and them would be like, come on, let's try something different. I'd be like, nope, I already know how this ride makes me feel. They'd leave, I'd stay. I was straight riding alone. Told them I'd meet them at 6 at the haunted house. In his Jaguar speeding down, I was thrilled. Most drivers would be cautiously riding the breakdown hill. He was all gas pedal. I was curious and turned on. I couldn't wait. My dick is longer than my tail. Kept repeating in my mind. I could feel my pussy pumping. Child, listen. Give me just a second, you guys. I gotta switch this thing around. My thing is not charging properly. Trash. Okay. All right, so let me say hey to anybody that came in. Hey Mimi was reacting to the sound of the smells, her description of the smells. Mother was laughing at me, laughing. Hey, hey, Elizabeth. Hey, 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 girl, hey. You just got the notification? All right, yes. All right, well, welcome, darling. Glad you're here. Welcome, welcome. All right, so let me keep going. So she could feel her pussy pumping because he said his dick is longer than his tail. Excuse me. You are probably hungry, he said as he carried me over the threshold of his front door. It was not a palace or a mansion. It had more of a weird warehouse feeling, or maybe more like an old fire station that he bought and redecorated. That was genius to me. Inside was as dark as outside of his building. Maybe that's why he held me in his arms. He didn't want me to trip or bump into walls in an unfamiliar location. I dig that. He put me down on my feet. Stay there, he said. I didn't reply, just waited. The area suddenly lit up. It was a flame, though. A torch on top of a metal pole that was cemented into his hard top floor. That's crazy, I laughed. Fuck the utility companies and power bill. And since this was an old fire station, with high ceilings, no worries about an uncontrollable fire burning down the entire spot. Only thing is, with a flame, I can only see but so far. I hope he didn't want to do what we were about to do in the dark. I like to see my man's muscles moving, the expression on his face and in his eyes, especially the desire as he admires me, my look, and my body. We'll fuck first, he said. Fucking is better when both parties are thirsty and starving to death, he chuckled. He's bold, I thought. A take charge type of nigga. Usually I'm in charge, but I liked his rough style. He approached, removed my mink, and dropped it right on the floor. He picked me up again, then sat me on the mink and began carefully removing my red python boots and sat them together to the side. He began massaging my legs. Ooh. That felt nice. He tore my Chanel dress right off of me as though it was made of silk and not the thick, luxurious brocade. I like that his desire for me makes him too impatient to search for a zipper, a string, or a set of buttons. He got a Jaguar and a strong house, so I'm telling myself to disregard that he ripped up my $6,000 custom Chanel made just for me. I should shower first, I said softly like I was some shy bitch. Hovering over me, he ignored me for some seconds as he pressed his nose into my armpit and inhaled deeply. He moved to the next pit and inhaled deeply. He moved to my bare pussy and inhaled deeply, his nose creating an extra sensation when it grazed against my clitoris. Shower, but don't get too clean. I get high off of the funk, he said, exhaling. Oh, yeah, I said, sultry-like. The reality was, though, I had never heard no line like that. Well, you got some real get high? I asked him. He smiled and said, why, of course, I'm the master of smoke. He stood and went into a clothing closet and pulled out a bag from a coat pocket. He lit the blunt so swiftly I never saw him strike the match or click the lighter. I didn't give a fuck. He got high off the funk. I get high off the blunt. He passed it to me. I'm puffing lock. Finally. The shower is down that hall to the left, he said, pointing. But don't wash too long. Leave your pussy as is. I'll clean it with my tongue, he said. I leaped up, the ripped mini offering him more than a glimpse of my juicy. But it was a glimpse that he would have had to catch through only the flicker of the flame. I ran straight, knew he was watching, let him see my booty bounce. Then I turned to the left, turned on like a motherfucker. In the warm downpour of the first water that I could actually feel while cleansing my body, my feelings towards this nigger began to multiply. He had brought feeling back to me after death, said he preferred his woman to have a few scars. He made me able to walk when I had been stuck seated by the sewer, inhaling something fouler than sewage. He fastened my seatbelt, carried me into his home, gave me my first after-murder blunt, and now he made it possible for me to shower and not be some strange, invisible, waterproof bitch. When I finished showering, I couldn't find no towel in his dark bathroom, so I stepped out cautiously, dripping wet and butt naked. When I did, there were now 12 flames up high, each atop of a metal pole. I didn't see him, though. However, I could see his fucktastic gymnastics bedroom that was out of this world. It was not expensively designer decorated. It was not made of sterling silver, platinum, gold, or even pearls. It was made of sturdy steel. What made it dope, though, was its uniqueness. This nigga had a huge bed covered by a black silk duvet, black silk sheets, and six black silk pillows that were not too fluffy. That was all high-end normal, but what made it ill was the bed was enclosed by a network of monkey bars, the same monkey bars we had in city parks, except his was much wider and taller and more intricate. The mattresses sat in the middle. The bars ran high up to the high ceiling overhead and to the left and right and front and back and side of his bed. It was elaborate. In big city parks, the monkey bars were made for a bunch of kids to go climbing and swinging all at once, but his bars were higher and stronger and apparently made for one man, him. I walked around amazed by his setting and slowly searching for him. I was turned on by his hide and seek. The heat from the flames soon dried off the droplets of water from my shower. My skin was warming. When I rounded the back of the bars, I looked up. He was hanging up there naked. No, he was doing chin-ups on a metal chin-up bar, and his dick was definitely longer than his tail. Now, all I craved was to feel his strong stroke that he guaranteed he had. He must have felt my feelings. Grab hold of both my ankles, he said, as he lowered his body overhead. Head where I was standing. I did. He restarted his pull-ups with me holding on like crazy beneath him. After six pull-ups, my fingers began to slip. He jerked his body sideways, which threw me down to his bed. I loved the feel of the fall. Beneath the silk duvet, his mattress was not soft. He leaped down swiftly and flipped me over face down. It felt like under the silk bedding were rubber thorns. Next thing I know, this nigga got his nose pressed deep into my ass. Both of his hands were pulling both of my butt cheeks open. He withdrew his nose and hands and then laid on top of my back. You overdid it, he whispered in my ear. The asshole is too clean. I ignored him. I was concentrating on how good the weight of his body felt on my back and the rubber thorns felt pressing up against my front. He put his hands in my hair, massaging my scalp. All niggas do that with a bitch like me. They are each amazed that my silky, long black hair is real and grown up from my scalp. Most chicks catch fever if a nigga even thinks about putting his hands in her hair, upsetting her glued in, stitched in, laced in, braided in weave. Massaging my shoulders, my feminine diamond cut back, my tight waistline, and my rump, he eased off my body. Without leaving his bed, he slipped some kind of cloth around both my ankles and my body jerked up, feet first. I was in a dangling upside down type of headstand. With both of his strong hands, he pulled my legs apart until I was stuck in an upside down split. When he had me in the position he obviously planned to have me in, he buried his face between my thighs and began cleaning my pussy with his tongue. I didn't notice it when we was in his black jag, but his tongue was unusually long. It was sweeping into each area of my most intimate space. I was trapped in the good feeling he was making me feel. Then he sucked where he had been cleaning and held the suck until my insides bursted in his mouth. It felt so incredible. He knew he was good at it. He pulled his face back and said, "I promised to clean it." He reached up, released my ankles, and I fell to the mattress again in the midst of multiple orgasms. It created such a thrill in me. I was out of control of my impulses. He leaped down beside me on the mattress and looked into my eyes. I wanted him to tongue kiss me. He didn't. He plunged into me with that hard, strong, and thick, long flesh pipe. It was the strongest stroke. He was right. It was the best feeling. Each pump created such intense pleasure, it felt like even my eyes would pop out of their sockets. Coming continuously, I ran out of breath and energy, even though he was still doing all of the work. He flipped me around. Next thing I know, he pushed into my asshole before I could say no. I didn't get down like that. It was either before I could say no, or was I really with it? Was I so overstimulated that I just let it happen, wanted it to continue? Several strokes later, the 12 flames went out all at once. I couldn't feel him pumping anymore or the weight of his body pressing down against my back. I was in complete blackness once again. Shocked, I couldn't feel my arms, my legs, or my own pussy anymore. The feeling was not even numbness. Even numbness would have been a feeling. It was as though my arms and legs no longer existed. My body felt like it was just one long flowing thing without a sturdy spine. I need to get to a mirror, was my instant thought. Then I remembered that a dead bitch doesn't have a reflection. But hadn't he made me come back to life, though? Didn't he give me limbs that feel and a pussy that pulsated? Didn't he say he saw me clearly when, and even described what I looked like accurately? So maybe I will see my reflection this time. But how will I find a mirror in the dark? And even if I find one, I still won't be able to see. How could my body move forward without legs and arms? Before I could formulate the answers to my own questions, I was crawling without legs or arms, fingers or toes. But clearly I was moving forward, searching for a mirror. I smelled something I had not noticed before. I lifted my head a little and felt lightheaded. I was realizing that now I was hungry. I had never been hungry since I was shot dead. My mouth involuntarily opened widely, then snapped shut solidly. I was chewing meat, soft bones, and blood. I was swallowing, satisfying my hunger on the floor in a corner in the dark. Okay, let me see what y'all saying. Let me see. Hey, family, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, Love Muffin. I appreciate you. Mother said, talking to Satan himself, the deceiver. You think so, Mother? Ooh, happy all day said, right. Lexa said, that's got to be Satan. Oh, Lord, Lord, Lord. Let me see. Okay, y'all speaking to each other. Child, listen. This child said she was satisfying her hunger on the floor in a corner in the dark. Okay. What was she eating? All right, let's find out. Still the same chapter. Let's press on. A doorbell or a ringtone, I couldn't tell the difference, but I heard his voice answering. He wasn't on the floor where I was. He wasn't even on the bed where he and I had been, seemed like seconds ago. His voice was coming from way up high. He must have been sitting at the tip top of his monkey bars, or maybe he decided to do a few more chin-ups. How could he do more exercise after that thorough sexual workout? UBS, what's up? I heard him say, rough but gently, affectionately. His tone caused me, what the hell is going on in my eyes, caused me to feel pissy because he wasn't speaking to me. You'll never know what's up, you filthy bottom feeder, a female voice answered back. Seemed like he had her on speakerphone, and I swiftly figured it was his ex. I know you love me. You're always prowling around my territory, he said coolly. The devil is a liar every time, she said passionately, but calmly at the same time. What did you call me for? I know not just to disrespect my father. He said strangely. Your father can go straight to hell, she said hatefully. That's funny, he laughed genuinely. What did you do with my mother? She asked, oddly. I thought it was bizarre. Ex-lovers heated over their parents. You and I need to make a deal this time, she said desperately. Too late. It's over. If you don't want to come to my playpen, talk face to face, in my bedroom, you and I will never have any deal to make or anything to discuss, he warned, and invited her at the same time. Next, I heard the sound of fireworks, like on the 4th of July. I suddenly saw explosions of sparkles. That bitch must have been real mad. But if she wasn't here in his bedroom and she was on the phone, how did the fireworks happen? You sent your bullshit army of I guess this is UBS, but it's UBS, of your UBS to my crib? I heard him ask her. Why don't you step outside and check? Maybe I'm right here at your front door, she said. Next, I heard him swinging down on his bars. Was he that excited to see and welcome her in when me and him just finished fucking and I'm still here? I crawled till I bumped into one of the metal bars. I wrapped myself around it and crawled upwards. I paused to listen for where he had swung to, but I never heard his feet land or him walking across the floor towards his front door. You must be scared of my little bullshit army, she said, after having not said anything for what I guess was some seconds. Now she was baiting him to open up his firehouse door. I was glad he didn't. Or is it that you're in there staring in one of your six mirrors, worshiping yourself, she asked. She sounded bitter and a little bit crazy. Her words were followed up by a piercing whistling sound, and then a loud boom shook the firehouse fortress that seemed unshakable. It was like a bomb had been thrown through the roof and had exploded in the air. Instead of causing the firehouse to collapse into nothing but rubble, like how places on the TV news reports look totally destroyed after a bombing, it lit up the entire inside with sun-bright light, much brighter than when the flickering torch flames were the only way to see. When it did, I could see everything that I could not see before. He was squatted on the bottom rung of his monkey bar, still nude, and his feet perfectly balancing his powerful body on the bar, even as the house shook. And in an instant, I could see his reflection through the wall-to-wall mirrors, which I had not noticed framed his large warehouse playpen. Strange thing was, I could see another reflection as I crawled his way. I was on my belly. When I moved, it moved. When I lifted my head, it lifted its head. When I stopped to stare at it, it stopped and stared back at me. Unexpectedly, because it was not something anyone would ever imagine is desirable or even possible, I, fully awake and with my same Winter Santiago mind and thoughts, had turned into a red python. All right, so that's the end of chapter 6. Okay, so Black Diamond said, this is turning my stomach. I really don't remember finishing this book. I believe I stopped reading. You said it's turning your stomach? Oh, my goodness. Yeah, it's a lot. But, you gotta read it. Yeah. It's a lot, though. It's not for everybody. Are y'all liking it or no? Because I'll stop, child. We can stop and scrap this right here and move on to the Midnight Story. Because I don't want anybody to feel like, you know, what the heck? Is that yes? Is going on with this mic? Is that yes, y'all want me to stop? When oh, Black Diamond said all of those damn sixes. Yeah, a lot of sixes. You peeped that, eh? So family said you gotta finish what you started. So some people like it, some people don't. Maybe do it as a pre-recorded and upload. Yeah, maybe. Maybe I can do it as a pre-recorded and upload like that, maybe. All right, well, I'll finish these because I said 5, 6, 7, and 8. So I'll go through 8 and then I'll stop and we can come back and just chit and chat because it's only been 1 hour and 5 minutes and we got through 2 chapters. Okay, all right. So chapter 7. Another wind war. I could feel it coming before it hit. I'm super sensitive to the ground. Could always hear the vibration of feet or anything that impacted the earth that I crawl on. I could hear the howling and his house shaking and things being tossed and slung and flung around. I could hear chains rattling and fireworks going off. I could hear the clash, not of fists, but of forces of the wind. After a nasty breakup of any couple, the war begins. I knew bitches who keyed their ex's ride or punctured his tires or banged in his rims with a hammer. I knew bitches who beat the new bitch's ass who her man had replaced her with, or even stalked her, then choked her, stabbed her, shot her, or murked her. I knew even liver bitches who, instead of killing his new bitch, killed him. I knew bitches who ran up his credit cards, crashed his car, cut up his clothes, pawned his jewels, and even burned down his house. But when a man or woman who used to be lovers living together, working together, eating together, showering, and fucking together, and one betrays the other, betrayal makes the matter more meaner than murder. Because you can just kill someone if you want to, no matter who you are, no matter who they are or where they hide. They bound to resurface eventually. Let down their guard eventually, and that's precisely when they can get got. But ex-lovers, who more than just creeping and fucking other niggas or bitches, where one betrayed the other, told a life-changing secret that he or she had confided with, sold him or her out to his or her sworn enemy, called the cops on him or her for any damn reason, flipped on him in a court of law, or was way worse, like working as an undercover police, a bitch-ass informant, spying and telling on his or her lover, murder ain't enough get back. A betrayed nigga or bitch wants to be the one who delivers the hurt over an extended period of time. Not a quick stabbing or gunning down. A betrayed lover wants to witness his or her traitor in severe loss of either wealth, status, or something or someone he cherished. A betrayed lover wants to see the traitor in actual excruciating pain. He or she wants to taunt and torture first and then deliver the last blow that leads to the traitor's complete and final downfall. I know. Bullet was the main one who betrayed me. He's at the top of my payback list. He was my nigga for many months before I got arrested. Yeah, he was a hustler. I fucking love that. His fuck game was strong. I love that too. Once he and I first hooked up, I never fucked around with no other nigga but him. I'm a loyal bitch. Loyalty runs through the Santiago blood. But he never fully acknowledged my loyalty to him. He never gave his loyalty to me. It wasn't about me thinking, expecting, or believing that he was out fucking some random bitches while we was together. He didn't cause me to feel or think that he was. It was that he, I don't know. He loved me with his mind and body, but never gave me his heart. He treated me like a suspect who was bound to turn on him or turn him in. I wasn't. I'm the one bitch that wouldn't ever. Santiago's are born snitch free. Bullet put our Manhattan condo in my name and every purchase he made for both of us in my name. Back then, at the time, I thought that meant he loved me. Of course I did. He provided. In turn, I covered for him here and there, held his coke, concealed his weapons, and carried his cash here and there quietly whenever he told me to. I was trying to earn my way up and also in to his heart. I thought we should be on some Bonnie and Clyde shit, but fuck Bonnie and Clyde. We should be on some Winter and Bullet shit, stacking our chips and styling and fucking and eating and chilling and staying together. Turned out, he put everything in my name, not for love or for providing for a top bitch and daughter of legendary hustler and entrepreneur Ricky Santiago. Instead, Bullet was on some Brooklyn scheming. He made it so that if everything or anything went wrong, he could drop all the legalities and blame onto me without losing any street credibility because it wasn't like he snitched on me. He simply left a paper trail, documentation, all in my name that told the fictitious story of me being the hustler and him being blameless, unarrestable, and scot-free. On the day of my arrest that led to my conviction as a drug dealer sentenced to serve 15 years on a mandatory minimum, which at the time I had never even heard of, my nigga Bullet had a car rented with a credit card in my name. In the rental car was me and the product. I was about to ride round trip to Virginia on a run with him, a big and necessary business move. Simone, who for some reason can't get the fuck out of my mind or life or death story, saw me sitting there on our Brooklyn block in the rental waiting on Bullet. I didn't see her though. Simone had bullshit beef with me that she swore was real. So, soon as she saw me that day, it was on. Bitch threw a brick through the rental window. Bitch dragged me out the car swinging. We thumped. My nigga Bullet saw the rah-rah from the distance. He started rushing over. He fired one shot in the air to cause the commotion to break. Seeing him boosted my confidence, but the gunshot distracted me from keeping my eyes on her. Simone took advantage and sliced my face. Bullet held my bleeding face in his hands. He saw me back. He sat me back in the rental car. He tossed the gun beneath the seat. He walked around to the driver's side. I was relieved that he had rescued me, but the furious fight and the gunshot drew out the cops. The cops swooped in, and Bullet, instead of jumping into the rental car and speeding away, walked off calmly as if he never was with me, never even knew me, and never intended to get in the car with me at all. I was arrested in the rental car that was in my name, with the weight stuffed inside teddy bears and the weapon tossed beneath the seat. They cuffed, fingerprinted, mugshotted, jailed, grilled, and investigated me. They asked me for names or just one big name. I gave them nothing. I rejected their bullshit tricks and games. The name is Santiago, royalty, not rats. I wasn't mad at Bullet for being a hustler, obviously. I wasn't mad at him for renting me the condo or even for taking me on his big business run to Virginia. I was down for him. I wanted to go. I didn't like being left out of the business or the action. It's that that nigga Bullet didn't come for me. He didn't add a dime to my legal defense. He didn't send one of his men to make sure I had all that I needed. He didn't put 1 cent on my commissary. He didn't write me one letter, slip me one kite from his people's own lock. He didn't check for me, and to me, that meant he never loved me. That's why he's on my payback list. He betrayed me. I never betrayed him, not even once. So, I understand this little 16 years young looking one, oddly named UBS, who is tight and at war with her ex. He seemed more my age than hers, but I knew that once a bitch blossoms, gets curves and titties, and hungry between the thighs, whether or not she's 12, 13, or 16, whether or not the law says she's a minor, she is bound to hunt and chase down a man she chooses for herself. A young, sexy bitch, I know, can make it impossible for even an older guy to resist her powers, no matter who he is. He could be handsome or ugly, paid or broke, married or single, hustler or preacher, politician or teacher, doctor or lawyer, or even a goddamn judge. I accept that, as long as it's not the other way around. Some old guy hunting, cornering, and chasing her young ass. Fucking and raping are never ever the same thing. He says she betrayed him. He said she's the police. She seemed too young to be anybody's police. And in the, I guess, seconds I had seen her, she didn't seem like a cop. But I ain't from down here. I don't know how shit goes around here. Everything is unexpected. It's like I'm stuck in the world of the unseen and unknown and can't control or predict the action. But now I am not alone down here. Of course, I choose him. He chose me in the first place. He was the greatest sex I ever had, the wildest feeling I ever felt. He was the only man who ever caused me to let go of midnight, who never fucked me at all. I like a man who gives a bitch what she wants, a man who doesn't make a bitch feel lonely. Wife number five. Oh, hell no. That would never, ever be me. My new nigga is my forever nigga from now until the real lights out. Even though he only fucked me once on the same night we met, I was able to exist inside of that fucking memory. And unlike Bullet, who left me because I was cut and bleeding and would obviously wear a scar, and who set me up to take the fall or either didn't set me up but reacted only to secure himself, my forever nigga is different. When I became the red python, my forever nigga kept me, adored me, even allowed me to crawl all over his beautiful body, no matter what time or where he was at the moment. Even if he was busy, I could wrap myself around his neck. He is a thousand times smarter than Bullet. He knew I was poisonous and quite deadly, but apparently he was 100% certain that I would never ever bite him. This nigga kept it real. He still brought home and fucked other bitches. I'm sensible enough to know that if he couldn't fuck me in my condition, he had to fuck someone. He didn't try to sneak or hide any of them. He even let me watch. After the sex, he showed me his loyalty, threw them random bitches right out. I remained because we lived together. He fed me. He shared his monkey bars, which I used to stay fit. He even talked to me, even though I could not speak back like a human being. I could only gesture. He told me that I was the sexiest serpent ever, and that I would make a mean ass belt, handbag, or pair of heels or boots, but that he would never ever allow anyone to swipe me from him or hurt me in any way. But on the day of the most recent wind war, he wasn't home. I was hanging there on the bars waiting for his return when the firehouse was attacked. As our firehouse rocked, I promised myself that if the bitch UBS came in here, which she had not been able to do any other time while he was alert and home on watch, I would bite her with full venom. Unexpectedly, without her entering our house, I was sucked and pulled into a vicious vacuum-type current and fast-forwarding through blackness once again. As soon as the fast-forwarding stopped, and while my mind was still whirling, I was immediately mugged by the odor. Oh no, I thought, I'm back in the sewer location. I'm in the sitting position on the curb next to the gutter. Now I had arms and legs and fingers and feet. I touched my face. I could feel it. I even had my silky hair back. I was a human. Oh shit. I would have celebrated, but instead I was coughing from the stench. I reacted, wanted to jump up and walk away from it. However, I could not move my legs. I hated that. Thought it was foul play. Rather see my enemy face to face and have the opportunity to fight and change the action. I don't like the feeling that someone is trying to control my story, my life, and even my life after death story. I was uncertain how many days I sat there alone in the overwhelming blackness. However, I could count the number of unexpected events and the ways in which it affected my body. My body. I repeated to myself. Was it even mine? How could it be when I could turn into something other than me? Some inhuman thing that I never chose to be. But it had to be my body because even after I got shot dead, my mind never shut off. My thoughts continued. They were my same thoughts. I was thinking the exact same way I have thought about things for as long as I can remember, and I have a great memory. No matter what other thing I became, no matter alive or dead, I was certainly, throughout it all, me. And I still was. I'm the crippled version. My arms and hands work, but my legs don't. I wasn't going to start crawling on my belly like I had to when I had no other choice. I wasn't going to make my way across the street from the curb I was sitting on, using my knuckles to carry the weight of my legs like some monkey. I wasn't about to be on some special Olympics type vibe and walk on my hands. Besides, where would I be going? It was black where I was and black across the street from me. Reminding myself to exist in the moment and not get caught up in bullshit depression. No matter who you are, depression is a fucking waste of time that people with no action and no brain to tell them how to get the action started or flip an inactive situation into something brand new are enslaved to. Having that thought reminded me not to get hung up on the what ifs or what would or could or should have been. I'm a motherfucking survivor no matter what, so I endured the things I had become immune to. The blackness, the breaking of bones, the waves of heat that scorched my ass and the soles of my feet. The chorus of millions screaming different words and sounds, but all at once, the sounds of 99 niggas cracking their knuckles, the scraping and grinding, even the hissing. The hissing had become my only form of music down here. For serpents, hissing is like rhyming. I wasn't prepared for the add-ons, though. A swarm of tiny flying insect type things. I call them that because they reminded me of the aggravating existence of mosquitoes. But I couldn't actually see them. I don't know if they were mosquitoes or not, but they came through suddenly in a violent swarm, attacking my face and eating me. When I would touch myself, there would be rashes on me, which was something I never had. I never even had the chicken pox or the measles when I was a kid. I tried not to scratch because the scratching only satisfied me for what felt like a few seconds. Then the rash would feel moist and spread further. I don't know if it was blood or what oozing from the rash. This was disturbing. On the low, I was waiting on him to find me. I was 100% sure he was out there searching for me. I wanted him to show up, but not while the rash was on me. Then there would be coughing spells. Felt like it lasted for days. All I could do was cough and could never catch my breath. Next were the sneezing spells that always came after the coughing, but never both at the same time. When I would sneeze, which was continuously, it felt like my organs were going to fly out of each of the openings in my body. That's how powerful the sneezes were. There were no tissues. There was no one to help or who would even complain that I was sneezing germs onto them. Instead, my fingers felt the mucus accumulating on and around me. It was a good thing that I was back to being a dead human. It meant that I was never hungry. If I had been hungry in that situation, the mucus would have been all I had to eat. That is fucking disgusting. Oh my God. I was sitting in my slime when the green-colored atmosphere began to devour the blackness. My eyes were attempting to adjust to the new existence of color that contained light. The greenness somehow eliminated the foul odor, silenced the screaming and the grinding, cracking, breaking, and hissing. Although I was happy about the presence of color, I was worried that he was about to show up to come get me, only to see my rashes and scratches and my lap filled with mucus that had oozed down over my feet. What the fuck was she going through? Instinctively, I touched my face, wanting to clear and clean it up a bit, if that was even possible. When I touched my face, it was not slimy anymore. It was not bumpy. It was not wet. I moved my hands over my whole face. I could not even feel my scar. My hair felt soft, no more grease or residue or dead insects from the swarm. I pulled it to my nose. It smelled like it had been washed with expensive shampoo. My mood was shifting up. I was excited. I leaped up. My legs were working. The feeling of being able to really feel returned. As it did, the lavender sky appeared overhead. It opened and spilled out stars that were absolutely everywhere, like diamond raindrops. Alhamdulillah, she said. Or at least that is what it sounded like. It was her. The Diamond Rain girl, who I had seen once before. The one who he said is the police. Subhanallah, she said, and I was already getting tight at all of her foreign talk. I apologize for being too late, she said, switching to English as though she heard what I said just thought, or as what I had just thought. Immediately, I switched to my game face. I thought she had caught me slipping and read my facial expression. I had been so long fucked up, sick and paralyzed by the sewer in the blackness that I had no reason for game face. Now I was back in pocket and even feeling like I got superpowers. I must. I'm standing up, feeling myself. My skin is flawless, like how it was for the first 18 young years of my life. She began speaking to me in a tone as though I knew her. I'm not from this realm. I even have to get permission to come down here and my army of my UBS to back me up, she said. But I had thought UBS was her name. Maybe not. Above her, the sparkling stars continued to decorate and light up the lavender sky. I could see and understand clearly why he liked her. That aggravated me. She obviously had something that the rest of us bitches don't have. Not even the exotic foreigners. Never met a bitch that came from the stars. Stars more mesmerizing than flawless jewels. Somehow, she controlled the color of the atmosphere. Probably she could keep a nigga fully entertained with just her light little or with her little light show. Yes, love and light, bitches. And if the trip down here is not exhausting enough, the battle is, Diamond Rain said. I looked her over. She didn't look like a bitch who had been fighting her way here the way she said she had to do. She didn't have no scratches or knife swipes or burns or bullet holes, and even her clothes were neat and fresh. The belt around her waist had slots stuffed with what seemed like big bullets. They were not exactly the same as the bullets I seen plenty of times in Brooklyn, but they definitely appeared to be ammunition. I'm sorry, you guys. Around her neck was a diamond chain. She's stunting on me, I thought. But the illest thing about the chain was her piece. I had seen the jewels of the hottest hustlers, my father at the top, of course, and his crew, celebs and dealers at VIP parties, as well as low-level cats from our hood that were on the come up. I had never ever seen any hustler or celeb with the piece she had hanging on her necklace. It was a grenade. This must be part of her psych game, I deduced. She came with her pretty face and sleek body, nicely dressed, but wearing warrior armor in a way that it was on display to make the next bitch she was about to battle back off or bow down. If it was so much trouble, why did you come here then? I said without any excitement at all. She looked sad for a second, then brought back her smile. Maybe her smile is her version of her game face. Is that all you have to say to me? And do you really want to say it that way? Why not start with the good words and good feelings? She asked, and then threw her arms in the air. She held them there and made her pretty, unmanicured fingers dance and then spun around rhythmically like a belly dancer. I'm thinking, what the fuck? A knockout combo, bullets, bombs, and hula hoop hips. You must be like my halab, she said, striking the pose. Halab, I repeated. Yes, halab means the scent that announces me. It remains only while I am here and trails me when I leave this realm. How come you don't even mention it when before I arrived down here you were choking on odor? She placed her hands on her hips gently, not like a commander or authority. Of course, I smelled her beautiful scent, but one bad bitch don't really need to be complimenting another badass bitch for her look and her style. Real bitches already know and don't need compliments from anyone except their nigga. So I ignored her. Or maybe you like the lavender sky? These are all gifts that the one has allowed and given me. Alhamdulillah, she said the foreign word again. And I am so grateful to share these gifts with you, she added. Bitch, we ain't friends, I said. I wanted to cut out the bullshit niceties and get to it. Did you come here expecting me to help you catch him, or are you down here just to fuck with me? I asked her. Him? She said, and collapsed into a squatting position so that now she was looking up to me. I was like, that's right, bitch, look up to me. He is evil. He is the enemy. She stressed each word, raised her voice, but still had the happy face and delight. I didn't like the mixture. I see you're still salty over him, I said, but a real bitch lets go after she gave it her best fight, so let go. Besides, you disqualified yourself. You betrayed him, I blurted out so she would understand that he confided in me about everything and that I was aware of their past relationship and that I was even aware that she was the police. SubhanAllah. This is why we are shown that whoever the one leaves in error can never be corrected by anyone else except the one. Because of love, we UBS still try. And because the one is the most merciful, we are granted three trips of mercy to strive to correct the misunderstandings and wrongdoings of the ones we love, she said, mumbling some foolishness. Then she stood up. Please forget him. He is a liar. Every word he says is false. If you believe in him and follow him, he will lead you to an even more evil destination than down here. You will be completely ruined in his company. So you're not a cop. You're a CO who showed up to correct me. I laughed like, yeah, right. Beat it, bitch. Then I told her, after a breakup, all bitches talk just like how you are talking now. blot him out. It is not about him. It's about you and me. I don't know exactly what lies he has told you, but I have never ever had any romance or relationship with him. Bitch, stop lying. You keep coming here. You came to his house a bunch of times trying to shake him. You bombed his house and did all types of crazy shit. I know. I was with him the whole time. Bet you didn't know that. So you busted, I told her. True. Some of our army of UBS were there attacking his house of evil, she admitted. I was not with him, although I sent some of them, while others of them fought him for their own reasons. It felt like she really wanted me to take her side, to believe her words. You don't recognize me? She asked after some seconds. I know everything about you, Miss Winter Santiago. It really hurts that you don't recognize even one speck of me, she said softly. But I forgive you. You don't even know who you are, or where you are, or why you are here, or the meaning of what you have done in the past and what you continue to do in the present. So, why did I ever believe that you would be able to recognize even a speck of me? She said, as though she pitied me. I hate bitches who try and talk slick and who beat around the bush. Get to the point. Talk straight, I threatened her. Straight? That's a good word, she said, delighted all of a sudden. Can you handle straight? I was starting to heat up. Seemed like this young bitch thought she was a cut above me. Seemed like she thought she also knew a bunch of shit that I didn't know or that she thought I couldn't possibly figure out. So I took a good close look at her. She looked like a reflection of my younger self. I thought about the first time I saw her. Maybe she is Lexi or Mercedes or one or the other. I can handle whatever, but I control the action, I finally answered her in my big sister tone, because I am the first daughter of the Santiago household. I'm not going to have my youngest sister talking down to me as though she is my teacher, even if we both are dead. You said you know everything about me, right? I asked her. She smiled. Everything, she said, like there was nothing to it. What am I wearing? Was my first question. I didn't know the answer myself. I was checking to see if she could actually see me and what she saw. My look matters the most, I know. If I'm looking shabby to her, I know it changes my leverage in this position or in this conversation. Alhamdulillah, you are the most beautiful looking human to me. Of course, she said strangely. I used the mercy I was given to remove your scar because you seemed uncomfortable wearing it, she added, and I didn't like her flippant shit like I owed her something. She probably removed my scar because she knew her ex-lover lusts women with scars. Don't try and be slick. You still have not said what I am wearing, I reminded her. Suddenly, she started spinning round and round like she was trying to make herself dizzy. Then she started saying words like she was singing a song. Gucci, 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 Louis, 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 Fendi, 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 Chanel, 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 Hermes, 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 Birkin, 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 Louboutin, 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 Jimmy, 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 Choo, 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 and good Lord, Tom Ford. Okay, you are wearing it all. She dropped to the ground in a squat, then collapsed into a lying down position. Then she closed her eyes. I guess all that was her attempt to stop the dizzy feeling she caused herself. I like seeing her throw a tantrum and lose her cool. And I liked it even more that she knew the names of some of the top designers. And she was pretty and nicely dressed, her hair covered with the trademark intricate, delicate designs of a colorful Hermes scarf. Her sporting Hermes forced me to forgive her fashion-wise for covering her hair. And she was rocking her mean-ass saddlebag by wearing the strap like a sash across her front and the pouch on her ass. I like the reversal. Quality fabric, expensively stitched leggings complement only a sleek body type like hers. Big sloppy bitches or even little sloppy bitches at dollar store cheap leggings is a crime. Diamond Rain's fashionable leggings were also like riding pants that rich bitches wear on horseback. Oddly, she wore black leather ballet shoes with the ribbons crisscrossing up past her ankles. It wasn't my style. I guess her coming from the sky caused her to dress to travel light. She looked dope. I was willing now to give her that. Her fashion outburst had chipped off some of the ice between us. Lexi or Mercedes? I asked, looking down at her. The cars or your sisters? She replied, opening her eyes. She knew those were my sisters' names without me having to tell her. She passed that little test. Which one are you? I asked, still keeping it brief. Neither Mercedes nor Lexus are dead. Miss Winter, You are dead, she said, sitting up and turning the mood very, very serious. I am not Mercedes or Lexus. If I were either one of them, you would not ever have been able to see me or them because you are no longer in the realm of living humans. I didn't need no clarification. So, fucking what? You're a dead bitch just like me, I shot back. She leaped up. Otherwise, you wouldn't even be here. I am not a dead bitch, as you say, and I wish you would change your manner of saying things. It would be to your benefit. So, why exactly are you here? You said that I'm dead, yet you say that you can see me. At the same time, you said that I cannot see the living, and you say that you are not dead, but clearly I can see you. What are you then? I asked forcefully. Very good, she said, and I didn't like her slick compliments or how she spoke them softly with a smile. First things first. Child, listen. Okay, la ilah ha ilah. Why, listen, my late first husband was a Muslim and knew how to say all this stuff. I do not. Okay. Speak English or fuck it all, I threatened her. You must never follow up sacred words with niggardly words, she said, but I was tired of her foreign shit. English is only one of thousands of languages in the universe. UBS are suited to speak all of the languages in existence as part of our mercy. Alhamdulillah. Our mission is to be relatable. We introduce dead humans whose souls are lost and roaming in error to the path of cleansing. We show them how making prayers to the One is a means of protection for themselves. And also, it is absolutely the only path out of this area, she pointed out beyond the green towards the looming darkness that I had been stuck and sitting in. Then she continued, our prayers and praises to the One are always only in the language that the One revealed the truth in. So, when we are speaking to dead humans in their language, we will often add in some words of prayer and praise to the One. This is the proper way of speaking for all of us servants. And, Miss Winter, you and I and every soul are each and all servants of the Maker of all souls. Servants, I cracked up. Thought the bitch was pretty, but crazy, pretty crazy. Miss Winter, for you to get permission to leave this realm, you will need to stop mocking faith and stop blocking the truth, which your soul already knows to be true. Down here, the biggest wrongful error any soul can commit is to pretend that it does not understand when it does understand and has understood all along. This is a bigger wrong than murder or suicide in this realm. Do you understand what I have said so far? She asked me as she stared into my eyes. I just stared back at her, didn't say shit. So I'm here to help you place everything in the right order. We have already established that there is only one God who is the maker of all souls. If a soul does not feel and acknowledge this truth, every other thing and choice it makes will be completely out of order, all confusion and chaos. Is this some fancy Jesus talk? Are you down with those crazy Seventh-day Adventists who go around knocking on people's doors who they don't like, who they don't know, like they ain't got no damn sense? Back in Brooklyn, one of them got shot dead for knocking on the wrong door talking shit, I laughed. Shot dead. Same as you, Miss Winter, she said, and I felt an anger and a chill. Jesus, peace be upon him, was a servant of the One. Jesus was not a partner, an equal, a son, or a relative to the One. The One has no partners, no children, no equals. No one and none of us compare to the One who created time, created the sun, moon, and all stars, the universe, and all souls, spirits, and living things. Jesus was given many, many mercies from the One. Alhamdulillah. Mercy is something only the One can grant permission for and give. Mercy is the reason you can walk today and see, hear, touch, feel, and talk. In this realm, when you see the atmosphere turn green, it is an indication that the One has provided a mercy happening at that moment. And because the devil is a liar, him and his army of demons shows up and spreads mischief and confusion among the population of lost souls, such as yourself, Miss Winter. The demons prey on the weak-minded. Okay, I'll play the music when I finish here. Prey on the weak-minded and convince them that it was they who healed you, gave you feeling, healing, and mobility, sight and sound. Demons show up when they perceive the green color in the atmosphere, the same way the sharks show up when and where they perceive blood. The demons cannot and did not and could never give you anything good or useful at all. They cannot heal you or answer your prayers or save your soul. They cannot protect or preserve or prolong your life, or alter or interfere with your death and the return of your soul to the One. They are only evil demons lurking, luring, and striking at the right time to utilize the mercy that the One has allowed to further mislead the many lost souls. Once you or any lost soul falls for it, Shaitan, right, Shaitan, spelled Shayton, who is the devil and an evil whisperer, who makes millions of evil suggestions through his army of demons, whom he calls his sons and daughters, will mislead you to great harm. The key is, Miss Winter, without your permission, cooperation, and acceptance, the demons cannot cause anything whatsoever to happen to you. You must resist and rebuke them. Humble yourself to the One who created your soul and all souls and gave you life. Yes, Shaitan, Alexis, Shay. T-O-N. Young and sharp, she spit game like a real motherfucking pimp, a lady pimp. She was doing double talk, meaning she was talking about my forever nigga without admitting that that was what she was doing. She was throwing shade on him in such a way that she was twisting his character. She was so devious, she wanted me to flip on him and to believe that I made the choice to do so, and she had nothing to do with it. He had done so much for me. She wanted to flip it and make it seem like he had done nothing good at all. She was redesigning and repackaging my forever nigga as a powerless predator. She was like those crafty detectives that tried to get me to give up info leading a bullet. They came at me from so many different angles all at once. I didn't let them in. I didn't let them win. I wouldn't let her win either. Did she think that I preferred a life of being a boring ass praying servant to any fucking body? Hell no. Miss Winter, I have only 7 Earth minutes remaining in my mercy to you. I want to leave you with the information that you will need in order to cleanse your heart, mind, and soul, and make choices that will not destroy you any further, she said, interrupting my train of thought. She shifted her saddlebag strap. Now, the pouch was hanging in front of her. Her hand rested over it. You are extremely far away from Jhana, which is heaven in your English language. You are so very far away in terms of actual physical distance and in terms of spiritual distance, which prevents your soul's return to the One who created you. If the One chose to do so, you could be in Jhana in an instant, but you have not earned a place on any level in all of the peaceful, beautiful heavens, which is so vast that no mind can even imagine it. There is no pain, debt, deafness, blindness, paralysis, burning, screaming, breaking, cracking, hissing, plagues or viruses, crimes or torture or illness in Jhana. There are only good souls and good interaction and beautiful rivers and elaborate comfort. And most of all, there is great peace. She lifted her arms in a victory gesture. Guess she thought she had won me over with her talk. On the left hand, this realm, where we are right now, in the absence of the One's mercy, Alhamdulillah, has not even a molecule or grain of heaven. The same way you are Brooklyn born, the county of Kings in the state of New York, in the country of the United States of America, and all of those names accurately describe your prior location on earth, this place where we are standing right now is first known as the last stop before the drop, the county of the ungrateful, the state of ignorance, and the land of arrogance. Population is around 500 million, give or take 1,000 or so souls, depending upon their choices, prayers, and actions, she said. 500 million? I laughed. You almost had me, I lied. But I'm the bitch who sat here on this curb for what felt like 6,000 years. I was dead alone. There was no one here but me. 500 million? Yeah, right. Winter, you are able to lie. I am not. So, everything I say will be the truth. It is a condition of my permission to access my second mercy to you. Everybody lies, I said. She paused and didn't reply. Yes, you are right. Everyone who resides in the last stop before the drop is a liar, including you. However, I mentioned that I am not from here. Then what the fuck are you doing around here? Why are you sweating a nigga who is not from your hood? Who? She balled her hands into fists and set them at each side of her waist. I see that you don't even know his name. How could you? You don't even know anything about him, really. Down here, the real name is the name of the soul. The nickname is the name of the action. So, even though you don't care and never ask because you can only care and think and feel and concern yourself about yourself and him, the name the one gave my soul is Sadiqa. It means believes in the words of Allah and Allah's books. My nickname is Bomber Girl because I bomb the devils every time that I am not bowed in prayer or out on a mercy. I am a servant dispatched to destroy devils. Now, your guy, the name of his evil soul is Lucifer 66. He is the 66th son of his father, Shaitan, the head devil who is condemned to the eternal fire and likes nothing more than to invite lost souls to join him in his eternal misery. Lucifer 66 Lucifer 66's nickname is Dat Nigga. Listen, I know a dude who called himself Dat Nigga. Now I'm scared because, oh my gosh, when I tell you he was an evildoer, please believe me. But anyway, Lucifer 66's nickname is Dat Nigga because a nigga is a spirit, soul, or person who refuses with all of his or her will and might to learn, grow, and change. Also, he is called that nigga because he is a top recruiter for Shaitan, an expert at luring souls. I really can't believe that after your gruesome death and your periods of loss of eyesight, hearing, touch, feeling, mobility, and health, that you are still talking and thinking about him. She said to me, all indignant, yes, of course you are. He is the same one who you ran away with and left me for on my first mercy. Then she laughed. Me and 20 of my UBS chased after you. We were fighting fiercely and outnumbered by his 65 gins. They still couldn't defeat us, but definitely did slow us down considerably until we were too late to retrieve you. You had already willed to remain with him. We can detect evil jinns, but we cannot defeat the will of a dead human soul. All bitches talk greasy about their ex-boyfriends and baby daddies. Sometimes a bitch be telling the truth and sometimes a bitch be lying for 1,000 different reasons, I said, folding my arms in front of her. She needed to know that I could and should teach her instead of her trying to lead me around. Let me put you up on game, Farmer Girl said, spinning on her ballet shoes. She was somehow sounding like me. She stopped spinning, landing close up in my face, wearing an aggressive expression that was more familiar to me, but that she never had with me before. I liked this expression because I could see her anger in it. I was like, yeah, bitch, now you showing your real face. Blah, 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 I spit and then talked over her talk. Wow, how could a teenager talk so damn much? I see why that nigga cut your ass off. No man wants to hear all of that bullshit. It's a real downer. How could he even keep a heart on with you talking all of that shit? Fucking you must have been a nightmare, a total wet blanket. Fuck you if you think that I'm a stupid, dumbass, clueless, whatever. I know what a soul is. Soul is the feeling in the music, or the look in the fashion, or the style in the jewels, or the rhythm in the streets. My soul was created by my mama, who pushed me out of her big coochie after my father went in her repeatedly. Then I laughed a little. Okay, hold on, you guys.
Hey, the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Okay, thank you very much. Somebody wanted me to play the music, y'all. So I had to stop because this chapter is a little long. Now watch it end now that I done did this. Okay, I see y'all been talking. Child, listen. I'm going to get to y'all comments at the end of this chapter. All right, so let me finish. Funny you should mention Mama. She sang softly in a melody like they were lyrics to a song, withdrawing any trace of her anger. That got me thoroughly heated. Don't say shit about my mother. This may be another fucking realm, but where I come from, you don't say shit about anybody's. Oh, wait a minute. You don't say anything about anybody's mother unless you want to get knocked out, stabbed, or shot dead, I warned her. So, you do have some emotion, concern for, and memory of your mother. I did not think so. After your body was shot dead, the most merciful one allowed you 3 visitations of your choice. You did not even think about or ask about or choose to visit your own mama. Honestly, you would not have been able to have visited her, though, because she is no longer of the earth's living, and the 3 visitations are granted to say goodbye to the earthly living ones whom you cared about the most and whom you would miss the most as your soul exited the earth realm immediately after your death. Are you a fucking mind reader? I spit. How would you know if I thought about my mother or who I visited after my death? I cannot share with you just yet how I know. Well, shut the fuck up then. Here, she said, suddenly handing me her saddlebag. I didn't like that she was giving me some type of hand-me-down, even though it looked brand new. But it was Gucci dope style. So I took it. It was heavy. I learned from living in the streets that if anybody hands you a bag, you better look in it right then and there. Know what you're holding. So I looked. In it was a book so heavy that no one in their right mind would ever open or read it. Even I know an author should have some fucking consideration and keep it brief. That's why I love magazines. They're less wordy, more art and photography. Lord, that reminded me of somebody saying somebody needed a picture book. But anyway, child. Catch. All right. They are constantly updated. So they keep up with the flow of fashion, the movement of models, celebs, and caked up people, and display the finest furniture, newest technology, awesome travel destinations, elite products, and the flawlessness of jewels. I handed the saddlebag back to her. The book is an English translation of the Book of Guidance, the most important words revealed and written to the living. On its pages are the answers to every question you have and any one of us has ever had. Keep it in case you have a change of heart. The answers and the straight way will be right at your fingertips. There is a tiny dictionary in the bottom of the bag in case you don't understand a word. Just look it up. She handed it back to me. I didn't take hold of it. Bitch, you said I was dead. Why do I need a book of guidance with all the answers to questions for the living? I knew I trumped her. Showed her how smart she isn't, because the soul is eternal. You need to know what the difference is between good and evil, right and wrong. Once you read these pages, you will be able to distinguish and understand, and most importantly, self-reflect. Don't you care to know how come you are here at the last stop before the drop? Once you read, you will see the error in your choices and feel responsible for your missteps. Then you will will yourself to pray. Sincere prayers are the only path out of complete darkness. Beep, beep, a red G-Wagon rolled up, fully AMG kitted and rims glistening. It parked a short distance away. It had me mesmerized. Of course I had seen a Benz G-Wagon before, but never a red one. It was so mean it seemed to glow. The tinted windows dropped down. What are you waiting for? Get in, Lucifer 66, that nigga said. He was calling for me. My forever nigga showed up just like I knew he would. Mama Lana Santiago is not down here with you. She is in heaven, Bomber Girl said quickly. She thought she knew my weakness and tried to stab me in it. She stepped in close to me. trying to block him from my line of vision. She placed the strap of the bag over my shoulder. Maybe she thought that heavy-ass book would make it impossible for me to speed off. "Excuse me, Miss Winter," she said, downshifting her tone now that I obviously had a better option. "Before you decide which path to take, I want you to know who I am and why it might matter to you." In my mind, I was like, you are a non-fucking factor. Real bitches like bad boys. I'm the realest bitch, so I strutted right over to my forever nigga and hopped in. Through the blackened window, I could still see the spark of the diamond ring girl. Then, poof, she suddenly exploded and disappeared. She left a trace of her halal. The lavender sky and green atmosphere all faded to black as me and him sped into the complete darkness. I opened the saddlebag, admiring the grade and texture of the leather, as well as the detail of the stitching. I decided to keep it. I lowered my window and tossed that heavy-ass book right out. There was a foul breeze rushing into the rugged whip. Still, I kept my window down. I needed the air. I was concentrating on reducing my temperature. I had to prevent myself from suddenly turning into a blob of heat, especially before I got the dick down that I was anticipating like a motherfucker. The only interruption to my thorough excitement about being back to human and my pure enticement with him was my fury with that little bomber bitch who stood there with her bullet-lined waistline and a hand grenade around her neck. Yet, she tried to come off like she was some kind of fucking innocent angel. She needed to be armed, and she knew it. Without her ammunition and weapon, I would have never hesitated to whoop her ass for even mentioning mama and reminding me of shit I worked hard to forget. "I'm gonna need a drink," I told my forever nigga. "Something strong," I added. "I got whatever you need. Whatever I ain't got, I'll get it," he said solemnly, and I loved it. "What did UBS say that got you upset?" he asked me calmly. To which I replied, "Don't ever ask me about any other bitch. And when I'm with you, don't say no other bitch's name." All right, so that's the end of chapter 7. Ooh, Lord, child. It's a whole lot of, whole lot of. All right, so Alexa said, "Keep going, please." Mimi said, "I told y'all it was like supernatural porn. It gets worse." Yes, indeed it does. I told you, be quiet, be quiet, be quiet. Hey, Mimi. Hey, Mimi. Hey, Mimi. Shh, girl. So Black Diamond said, "Okay, soldier, you are describing hell with Winter as the new resident, which started with Chap and Veronica, which Winter rejected." So, hey, Mimi said, "Yes, at happy all day with your happy all day ass." I read this last year and I was thinking Sister Soldier must have been really horny when she wrote this book. Oh, my God. Listen, Sister Soldier don't get horny. You heard me? Don't say that. She don't get horny. She be in warrior mode all day, every day. Because the flesh, you got to deny it. I mean, I don't. But you know, people who ain't, you know what I'm saying, right? Yes, you got to deny it. You cannot be a slave to the flesh. Listen, sometimes I have to deny it too, because you know how many times I be on my knees in deep meditation. Let me tell you something. You have to deny your flesh, child. Because sometimes it'd be like, "Listen, fuck you doing down here praying for folks you don't know, when you could be upstairs, which ain't getting your groove on." I'd be like, "Yeah, no." Yes. All right, there you go. Yes. Child, listen. So that's exactly how she spelled it in the book. I will not tell a lie. That's how she spelled it. So Sister Soldier is truly awesome. So many clues. Absolutely. Absolutely. This book is, if you can hang with it, it's a lot, but you'll get it. So Mother said, "Winter Soul is being offered a second chance for Jonna," which is heaven. Yes. Tossing the Bible out of the window is no difference than sitting on a shelf with 3 inches of the child. Listen, that's what I say. People toss it out the window, child. They put it in the bottom of a box. Right. And then as soon as some shit happened, what's the first thing a motherfucker say? Oh my God. Right. Mm-hmm. So Happy All Day said, Winter is so material and money hungry, she can't even take time to think about anything. Listen, she thinks she know every damn thing. And I'm telling you, all it takes is for him to pull up in a fat fucker, even as a dead bitch. This girl cannot stop. She cannot stop being loyal to the wrong type of nigga, right? And then she cannot stop being just materialistic and sex driven. Because remember now, that's literally what was inculcated into her by her parents. Her mama, I'm a bad bitch. I got to make my daughter a bad bitch. All my daughters gonna be bad bitches. Santiago is her mama's forever nigga. He's her sun, her moon, her stars, her sky, the clouds, and his tears make the rain. Child, listen. He's the air she breathes, and she said, she don't think she would have been able to make it without him. And if he had gotten killed, she would not have. Proof of that? When he got locked up, first thing she did, crack, beam me up, Scotty. Right. Now she's a slave to a glass dick. Well, she was. She dead in the motherfucker now. But the point is, yeah. So he was her everything. So, of course, her daughter would think that her daddy was God's gift to women, and she only wanted dudes like her dad. That's it. Absolutely. Yeah, that's all she wanted, was dudes like her dad. If a dude wasn't flicking like Santiago, well, she was flicking his ass off of her like a mosquito on your arm in the summertime. You know how you don't smack it to kill it, you just kind of boom, flick it off. That's what she was doing. Mm-hmm. Yep. And she was willing to sit in the stench of hell with rashes and every fucking thing all over her body. She worried about what the fuck he thought about her. Bitch, you sitting in purgatory trying to figure some shit out. And you waiting for this nigga to come. And you worried about the bugs coming and swarming all over you. And you worried about how you look to him. You got snot dripping down your fucking face and all types of shit happening to you. It stinks like hell. You hearing breaking, screaming, grinding, knuckles cracking, everything, and you thinking about a dude, right? And can't wait to get fucked. That's what happens when bitches approach life from the position of a hungry pussy. Stop having a hungry pussy. You literally make all of the wrong decisions trying to catch that damn nut. It's like your first. There's some folks out here doing that shit and ain't even had an orgasm yet. And heaven forbid when they get one for real. When they get one for real, oh my God. No matter what that fool do, she ain't gonna never let him go. It's scary. That's scary. I know you lying. So anyway, let me finish. Oh, I got one more comment. Oh, I'm sorry. Some more comments. Oh, Lord have mercy. Yeah, fighting mode. Right. Okay. So Alexis says, so materialistic and self-centered, she didn't realize she was in hell until she was told, right? Yeah, you know, been in hell so long, she don't even realize it. But remember, Winter lived her whole life in hell. She just didn't know it. So family said, damn, I thought life after death was going to be about the dead mom. No. Hey, Tracy Cakes, did she say the mother was in heaven? She said your mother is not here. Yeah. Your mother's not here. There you go. That's a damn shame. Poor baby. Yeah. So anyway. I don't think she, I really don't think, anyway, I'm not going to, let me not spoil it, because let me keep going here in the comments. Soldier is saying to readers, your choice, heaven or hell, in Soldier's way. Absolutely. Yeah, your choice. Absolutely. Miss Mama.
Listen.
I don't even know if oh, I needed him to bring me up. What you call it, but that's okay. Yeah, we're gonna finish this chapter. We're almost done. We've been up here 2 hours with the bumps and the bruises and the breaks and carrying on. And then I'll stop and we'll have a quick little tete-a-tete, and then we'll just come back with kicking the Willy Bobo. Because I gotta tell you about this conversation. I'm trying to hurry up. All right, so we're going back. Hey y'all in the clouds in the shrubbery. I hope y'all like the video. All right, so chapter 8. I got an idea, he said in a more like a thinking to himself tone. He pulled the G-Wagon to a stop. I don't know what he was thinking, but we were still surrounded by pitch black. He opened his car door and got out. Stay right there, he commanded me. I wasn't going anywhere without him anyway. And as far as I know, there is nowhere to go. I was still tight because the teenage bitch's voice was revolving in my head. For some bullshit reason, I couldn't push it out. Funny you should mention mama. Funny you should mention mama. Funny you should mention mama. Her words and her voice were on a loop in my head. Bomber bitch was forcing me into deep thought when, in fact, I think that, dead or alive, there are subjects and topics and things that a person should never have to think about. A dead person should be dead and without thoughts. I am dead and thinking about precisely the things that I never want to think about. Bet all the assholes who committed suicide were shocked and angry as hell when they found out that dead is not dead, and they would be the same person after death with the same thoughts that they had thought they were ending, getting rid of, silencing. Now, Mama was dead center in my mental line of vision. In that freeze frame, she was Brooklyn Mama before the move to our luxurious Long Island mansion, before some nigga who was jelly shot her in her face and permanently altered her perfect look. But most importantly, the picture of Mama in my mind was before she ever toked a hit of that crack pipe. I knew, after having 15 years on lock, to just sit and think about it, that for me to accept my mama, aka Mama, aka Lana Santiago, aka the baddest bitch on the planet, after her crack breakdown would be the same as rejecting myself. No, it would be the same as destroying myself. Brooklyn Mama was the voice in my head. She was the image in my eyes, my pattern, my fabric, my fashion. She was all of the ingredients mixed together that made me, me. Mama was the most. She was the beautifulest, the livest, the baddest, the funniest, the finest, everything. I didn't need no books. Mama was all show and tell. She told me and showed me while she was telling me all that a bitch needs to know. Ooh, now that's not cool, she would say when I shitted in my diaper at age 2. That's how way back my earliest memories of mama goes. It is my first and earliest memory of anyone or anything, including myself. After mama said that, she taught me how to pee and poop, where to pee and poop, and how to clean myself thoroughly and smell like a lady always should smell. Come in the bathroom, she would wave me in. Always close the door while you do your private business. And remember, your private business and your business, both ain't nobody else's business. She would talk to me like I was an adult and then laugh at herself. But I knew she meant it, and I understood her perfectly. No potty, she would say, kicking the baby toilet into a corner. Sit on the real seat like I do, she would say, pointing. I would be trying my best to balance my little body on the toilet seat with the humongous hole. Now tinkle, she would say, like it was a magical thing, not just pissing in a bowl. While I tinkled, mommy would turn away and look at herself in the bathroom mirror while singing a song, which relaxed me. Mama had the dopest music collection of original singles and albums. She knew every song ever made from the oldest to the newest. In my first memory, she was singing All I Need, an old joint that she loved. She was doing Marvin Gaye's part and Tammy Terrell's twisting and turning her body while fixed on her own reflection. She was singing so passionately, I wondered, is she singing to Papa or is she singing to me or is she singing to herself? After that first memory, I remember Mama singing Everybody is a Star to me in the scented bubble bath as we bathed at the same time in the same tub. Mama was musical, and Papa had the whole house wired with speakers in every room, including the kitchen and the bathroom, so that Mama could be happy at home. All fresh and clean, Mama is carrying me wrapped in the thickest, softest white terry cloth towel to her bedroom, both of us sitting on her king-size bed. Mama would oil and powder and dress me. She'd comb through my silky hair like each strand was a thread of pure gold. All good. She would leap up and rush into her clothing closet to the top shelf where she kept her collection of eye catchers, showstoppers, high fashion hats. She would carefully select one and put it on my little head, drowning me in it. Tilt it like this. Lay it to the side, she would cheer as my little fingers attempted to adjust the hat to the style that was the only way a fashionable superstar like Mama would approve. Soon as I caught the right angle, Mama would be clicking her Kodak or pressing out Polaroids of me that would end up on her wall of photos of everything Mama loved the most. That was us, family. By the time I was six, Mama would play dress me in her real clothes with real bitch accessories so that I could walk down the runway that Mama made in the apartment corridor, which she lit up with colorful lamps and lights. I'd be killing the red carpet while the overhead speakers would be pouring out the sounds of Rod Stewart's Do You Think I'm Sexy? I worked the runway to all Mama's music picks, which could be anything because she knew everything musical. Donna Summer's Hot Stuff, Grace Jones's La Vie en Rose, or Slave to the Rhythm. Mama loved Grace Jones. Mama loved anyone and everything that she loved to the fullest. She was the loyalest woman on earth to anything or anyone who she chose. Mama marked time and her favorite memories through music. She loved to tell me her coming up stories. When she would be narrating them to me, it seemed she was more excited hearing the stories she was telling, even though she knew them all already and had told them to me or Papa more than once before. She never sat still when she was saying her stories. She was all movement, demonstrating, gesturing, and reenacting. She told me I was born a product of two songs. Betty Wright's Tonight is the Night. She wouldn't sing the whole song, just certain lines to highlight and prove that this song was her story. Mama said Betty Wright's song was the soundtrack to her 14 years young first love, first intimacy, first sexual experience with the one and only Papa. She'd be acting like she could feel herself giving up her virginity right while she was telling the story. She squeezed her eyes tight in anticipation, clamped her legs together like she was really nervous, and even had sound effects like ooh and woo and oh yeah. The other record that made me happen, according to Mama, was Rod Stewart's Tonight's the Night, because he was cool, sexy, and smooth, and only Santiago was sexier, smoother, and cooler than Rod without having to sing one note. Mama had more style, got more looks, and had more wigs than the Supremes. She could rock it long and silky to the back of her thighs, or wear blunt cuts, short, beautiful bobs, or her own hair in swirls of finger waves. She threw me big birthday parties, which could not be called just parties, because they were major events that niggas from BK to BX fought to get invited to. Many of the people who showed up, I did not even know, even though the celebration was for me. After the huge crowd went home, when only family remained, gathered in the ballroom, Mama would emerge dressed up on some karaoke-type vibe. She'd be Tina Turner and somehow lured Papa into dressing like he was Ike. He didn't sing, though. He just laid back and let Mama mesmerize him with her high energy and vibrant personality. No matter how she freaked it, Mama was larger than life and glowed more than any worldwide superstar. That's right. Mama taught me how to talk by always talking to me and singing to me. Come to think of it, hip-hop was Mama remixed, sampled, looped, slowed down, and sped up with a dope-ass beat beneath it. Mama is the reason why I love hip-hop. Mesmerized it like I memorized it. Memorized Mama and moved my hips to it up until this day, dead or alive. Mama taught me how to walk, whether it was on her homemade runway, up and down the project steps, or on the stoops, cement streets, or curves. Mama taught me how to stand, style, and strike a pose. Mama taught me body and style language, how to talk without ever saying a word, how to capture and wear the prettiest, most stylish, meanest fashions so I would never have to tell a next bitch anything. She would just stay the fuck back the fuck off because she knew beside me is not where she belonged. Mama taught me how to choose friends and be so badass that they would choose to bow down to my look without me asking or having to be snobby or shitty about it. What to share and not to share. What to give away and never accept back. What to keep and never allow anyone to touch, beg for, or borrow. Mama ranked and ruled everything, even her own real-life sisters, who were my aunts. She didn't say, so-and-so is number one, and this one is number two, or anything like that, but I could see Mama's words through her actions. Barbara, a.k.a. Aunt B, was her oldest sister. Mama had her babysit me from time to time. Aunt Barbara was appointed and paid to be babysitter to all of the family's kids, even though she hated children. The fact that we all could feel that Aunt Barbara didn't want to watch even her own kids was proof that Mama, even though she was the youngest sister of her family, was boss. Barbara did what Mama asked her to do. My Aunt Lori cooked the dinner meals for Mama. Mama would speed down the hall to her apartment, pick up the prepared foods, run back, set the table at our place, and pretend like she cooked everything herself. Aunt Lori knew better than to mention it, and she never did. Me and Papa knew the deal, of course, and so did Mama, really. But we went along with it because Mama was so cute in all of her ways. Mama's sister, Lila, got down on her knees and scrubbed our toilets and bathtubs. She was our Brooklyn Project apartment housekeeper. She waxed our floors on her knees without a mop. She vacuumed the carpeted floors, and she made our beds and did dishes and windows. In addition to paying her sisters, Mama treated them to spas and clubs, hair salons, concerts, sports events, and parties, and Broadway shows. Places they could never have afforded on their own dollar. Mama's brothers all worked for Papa. Mama made Papa commander over them. Usually men don't like that type of thing, but for baby sister Lana, who kinged and hooked the hottest hustler, everybody would do it her way because she was her. Besides, Papa made them capable, decent, and most importantly, hood wealthy. All of my cousins, my same age, and of course older, kissed my ass because I was Lana's golden child. So I learned how to rank everything and put everyone and everything in its proper place where it belonged, beneath me. By 13, I was 9mm dangerous, and I knew it. I didn't need no more instructions, homemade runways, or private concerts. I had watched and listened to and loved Mama so much, I was Mama, the young version. And because I was naturally a Mama-Papa combo, I was considered an upgraded version, a limited edition of Mama. Papa gave me that light skin and long black wavy hair look and pretty eyes with the long lashes that I didn't have to buy from the cosmetics counter or wigs or weaves from the hair store. Still, deep brown, flawless skin, brick house body, long-legged, forever young face, sultry Mama topped all. Any and everyone, everywhere we went. I would see boys to men of all ages, eyes dance back and forth, up, down, and all around as they tried to choose between us. For me, Mama was the queen and obvious best, my most luxurious, stylish, lovely one. She was hands down my most incredible possession, and Mama was my mirror. It was great becoming best friends with Mama, having someone in your teen young years who is not trying to stop you from living, feeling, running wild a little bit. Just for the experience and for the hell of it, is diamond class. She wouldn't expect anything stupid that other parents expected, like for me to be all in love with and enslaved to going to school, earning stupid-ass best attendance awards, or even getting good grades and studying. We had plenty paper. Papa earned it. We spent it. We had no reason to take the long bullshit route that lower-ranked, less-prepared families and people had to take. We weren't mad or mean to any of those people. Many of them were our friends, neighbors, family, and workers. Besides, like I said, they bowed down voluntarily. Brooklyn Mama would smoke a blunt and might sneak some lines of cocaine while running with her sisters. She would throw back a glass or two of champagne at our huge events, parties, and celebrations. Still, she could be overheard reminding all in our close family circle, crack makes us rich. Crack makes them crackheads. Then she would laugh her laugh that would trigger anybody listening to laugh along with her. Seriously, though, she would say while they were still laughing and she had switched her mood, crack is whack. Don't let it bring you down. Mama used to tell me when choosing my friends not to choose the children of the customers because customers are crackheads who can never, ever be trusted. Besides, they are beneath us and they don't get the privilege to come into our family circle, apartments, or our luxurious world. Crackhead mama erased Brooklyn mama, the phenom, who I thought would shine and live forever. Crackhead mama caused Brooklyn mama to drop down through all of the ranks that she set up. Crackhead mama unlocked the doors and let in all that was beneath us. The crackhead was doing every single thing that Brooklyn mama taught and showed me a real bitch should and would never do. Mama fucked up her currency. Her currency was her look. If she was my mirror, and she was, and smoking crack fucked up her look, which it did, what was that supposed to do for me? To me. 17 and a stunner, surrounded by my Brooklyn friends, I had since day one. Friends who competed with one another to be the closest to me. Friends who looked up to mama and who wished she was their mama. Friends who either never met their fathers, hated their fathers, or ain't seen that nigga in a decade, admired, sweated, and studied mama because papa wifed her, gave her everything, and stayed. Crackhead mama gave these same friends of mine who quietly worshipped me and eagerly bowed down the advantage and the opportunity to talk behind my back, laugh right up in my face, step right up to my rank and act like we was all of a sudden, equal. In the Santiago family, Santiago and me stayed true to the game. Even my sisters, Portia, Lexi, and Mercedes all rebounded, landed on their feet, and kept it royal. I never ever said it out loud, but that's why I pushed mama way to the back of my mind and deleted her from my talk, mention, and memory. And even if there is a Jana or whatever, and mama is there in heaven, if she don't look and feel and talk and act familiar like Brooklyn mama, I don't need or want to see her. To see her would be to kill my own self. And I never ever been a suicidal bitch. Crackhead mama was and is an unacceptable, complete fucking embarrassment to me. And that is the end, ladies and gentlemen, of chapter 8. So let's do a little quick check-in because I'm done with this book for tonight. Let's chop it up a little bit. Okay, let me see. Let me see. Give me one second. Y'all still here? Can y'all still hear me? Listen. That was cute. All right, let me do this.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
All right, so thank you for the Cash App, and the message in that Cash App says, for please tip the reader. Yes, you all are welcome to tip the reader, please and thank you. I missed that message earlier, so I had to play that again. I didn't even realize that that's what that message said earlier. All right, so what are y'all thinking so far about this book? Let me scroll back up to where I was. So, Mother said, remember, Veronica told Winter that Chap was telling her about Jesus, and Winter rejected that conversation. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep, Winter rejected the conversation. Child, Winter don't believe in God. Mm-mm, not at all. She rejected that conversation. She wasn't trying to hear that shit. She was like, go to hell, ma'am, real, 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 real fast. So, yeah, she wasn't trying to hear that at all. She was like, you go on away from around here, right, with that. So Love Jones was welcoming everyone. Oh no, she's welcoming Treacy to the Love Jones. Listen. Wait a minute. I can't remember that. I remember that song. I forgot that dude's name. But I like that song. You don't have to be alone in the love zone. What was his name? I was about to say it was what's the boy name? Y'all know who I'm talking about. He was an island dude, wasn't he? Somebody tell me that man's name. Who made the song Love Zone? Y'all know who I'm talking about. I like that song. Haven't heard it in a while. Okay, so family says, Sister Soldier, I have a two-part question. Do people who commit suicide go straight to hell without judgment, and the people who got murdered go straight to heaven without judgment? No, ma'am. I can tell you that. Nope. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. No. No. You don't go straight to hell. But you've been living in hell, and that's why you commit suicide. Mm-hmm. Yep. You commit suicide, your life insurance don't pay. That's for damn sure. But that's for damn sure. If you have it, but no, everybody got a, yeah, we ain't going there, but no, that the answer is no. Yeah. Winter did not steal from the church. She stole while she was in a church. The church got paid. Remember, Pastor got that check for $1,500. Mm-hmm. The church got paid. Winter stole from basically from Sister Soldier and the people that she helped who were the victims of AIDS. Mm-hmm. That's who Winter stole from. She didn't steal from the church. In the first book, yes, she didn't steal from the church, though. She was in a church when she stole money. There was a benefit going on in a church because it was big enough to hold everybody. And in that church, they were having this benefit. People were paying, I forgot how much, to get into the door. I think $20, right? And the church held, I forgot how many people, child. But anyway, it came up to a lot of money, and Winter took about $7,000 from them people. Mm-hmm. A whole fucking thug. Let me tell you something. You fuck around and steal from the less fortunate. Yeah, yeah. Let me see. Okay, there we go. Yeah, you don't steal from the less fortunate. Like, don't, if you don't need food, don't go getting it from the fucking food pantries and shit unless you need it. Don't, you know, and if you work at a food pantry, don't be stealing food out the pantry. Like, don't do that shit. Because, yeah, the universe, the source, whatever you want to call it, God, Allah, Buddha, Jehovah, Mother Mary, Yahweh, everybody, Krishna, Lakshmi, they all watching. Okay? Like, knock it the fuck off. You know? So, yes. Yeah. So is that in the first book? I have to go back. Yes, it's in the first book. Or you can go back and listen. I just did the first book. It's called The Coldest Winter Ever. And it's 20 chapters. I think I did it in 3 days, I think, y'all. I don't remember how many days it took me, girl. But anyway, you can it's right there. We just wrapped it up. So you can listen to it. But yes, it's in there. So, Hey Mimi said, remember the old lady she knocked over the head to? Yeah, Winter bust a old lady upside the head, took her diamond rings, took her money, and her credit card. Yeah. Winter's a beast, yo. She's like, fuck it. It's about survival. Always has been with her. That's her thing. Her thing is, you know, she got to survive. So, yes. Oh, y'all could hear me. Okay, yes, y'all could hear me. I didn't think y'all could hear me. How many chapters in this one, girl? I think it's 34 chapters, right? I know you lying. I don't know, child. Listen, it's 34 chapters, I think. So wait. Who? Winter? No, Winter is definitely not in yet. Yes, thank you, family. Tip the reader. Gratitude is the state of feeling grateful. Yes, grateful that your eyes don't have to cross. Billy Ocean, that was his name. Yes, that song got a nice funky beat. I like that beat. That song, I'm gonna listen to that when I get off of here while I'm getting ready to come back. I'm gonna listen to that song. I like it. I do like it. No, Frank Ocean is a what you call an artist or something, right? I was about to say Jeffrey Osborne, child, but no, Jeffrey Osborne made the other song I like. Don't you get so mad about it? Do you have to get so mad? I like, yes. Oh, goodness. Yes. I like that. Okay. So Winter, Veronica, Chap, and the rejected conversation leads us to Winter being in purgatory. Yeah, because you know Winter wasn't thinking about God, child. She was like, that's all some bullshit. I don't want to hear about it. Argue with your mammy. Right. She was like, go to hell, ma'am, and take the little spinning diamond ring, bitch, with you, right? Because I don't want to hear shit she got to say. All right. So Black Diamond said, okay, Sister Soldier, we have peaked you and the clues. Yes, indeed. Yeah. Listen, Winter is a slave to materialism and orgasms, child. Listen. And she will ride even the smallest of peens in order to get what she needs. But she likes a big fat one. And well, I ain't mad at her. You know what I'm saying? So yes, that's how that is. So Alexa said, hopefully Winter can redeem herself and get out of purgatory. Child, listen. I guess we gonna see, ain't we? You got to listen, Tracy. Ain't nobody gonna tell you, girl. We listening and we reading. Tracy Cakes, quit trying to rush ahead, child. That's the reason why I'm reading. So y'all can get it. Get it, get it. Okay, so Mother said, we have to finish the book with you reading, but at your time and will. How about that? I like how that sounds. Yes, indeed. I'm going to try to do, more chapters tomorrow. I was going to do that today, y'all, but listen, first and foremost, let me tell y'all something. Let me get off of here. I'll be back. let me read what Love Jones said. So Love Jones said, Evil Lynn says she believes Winter is going to find out a different perspective about her father that will change her perception of him and mess her up. So listen, check it. Now, remember, Diamond Rain, since that's what Winter called her, Diamond Rain says she only is granted 3 trips of mercy. The first time she came, Winter ran off with the devil, got her stroke on, and got turned into a red python. Then her ass got dumped. Winter is Regine Hunter. She keep looking for a nigga to carry her, and they keep dropping her ass. How about that? You know, Regine Hunter is from Living Single. I guess I must be Khadijah James. So anyway, yeah, that part. So she keep looking for niggas that to be like her father, and they're not. And what she doesn't understand is that her father ain't the dude that she thought he was, but she holds him in high esteem because she only knows a certain side of her daddy. She don't know who her daddy was when he was doing business. So, you know, hey, what can you do? Anyway, the fact of the matter remains that Winter keeps, whether she's alive or dead, she keeps choosing Ding-a-Ling over herself, literally. She keeps making the wrong choices in men, period. So So you said purgatory is a place that is talked about in Catholicism. So I'm confused with her being in this middle ground. Well, you do understand that, like, in no matter what faith you believe, there is a space where you sort of have this limbo state after you pass. That's why she said you're in the stop before the drop, right? Because they come and get you and pull you up because you're sitting in purgatory. You can really basically I guess like in Catholicism, it's about like expiating your sins. Purgatory is the space where you do that. So in purgatory, you basically have it's the space where you sit and get your shit together before you either ascend to heaven or make the drop into hell, your descent into eternal hell. So there's a space where you basically you sit after you die. Yeah, a waiting room, so to speak, where you have the will, the choice. I'm either gonna get right with God and ascend, or I'm gonna say fuck it and dance with the devil, and then you take that big drop, right? That's why he put his seatbelt on her so he could hurry up and speed the fuck away, because he knew that Diamond Rain and her homies was coming for Winter. They were literally screaming her name. They were coming to get her. Right. So, yeah, that's why he was like, you choose to be with me, right? Because I don't want you saying I forced you to come here. And he knew the type of chick she was, so he knew that he had to give her some a good stroke. Because listen, she liked the fancy car. Because remember, he first came in a Jaguar. Like, this nigga's got cars for days, and he Birdman with about 50 whips. Right, he got a bunch of damn cars, and he, like he said, his dick is as longer than his tail. Right, he liked her with a funky coochie. He liked her booty dirty. He told her, "Yeah, you can wash it up a little bit, but like not too clean, cause I want to lick around in the funk." Right, he said, "I like the funk," and she was okay with that. He liked the funk, and I liked the blunt. Right, he gave her weed. He put her in a bed, like literally, she was encaged in this cage. She was caged. Like all of the symbolism, like think about it, it's dark. All of the steel, the flames that just come right up out the floor, right? Yeah, all of like really, here's the deal. This fool got this woman trapped, and in all of her life, Winter has still not changed. She is 30 some years old when she dies, 32 or 33, and she the same chick. Like even doing a 15-year bid, she spent the whole 15 years hustling to survive, and she's okay with that. She's okay with that. So I don't know, I don't know how many levels there are, mother, to purgatory, because listen, I didn't get all deep into Catholicism, quite frankly. The whole the music and all of that shit scares me. I couldn't understand why their whole get down is about Mary. And I get it as a woman, that I guess they worship Mother Mary. That is like the thing for them. Yeah, I'm good. It's scary. It's too many getting up and getting down. Like I went to Catholic church with a friend of mine, and I was like, girl, listen, if we stand up and sit down one more damn time, I'm out, okay? Because I ain't gonna be able to do it, And then it was like, the priest, were quite racist. You know, they come around, supposed to be body of Christ. They put the little cracker, or whatever the fuck it is, in the mouths of the white parishioners. But when it came to the black people, they put it in your hand. So she was like, well, you go up there, you get on your knees. She was white. You go up there, you get on your knees, and you open your mouth, and they put it. I'm like, shit, well, how do I know his finger didn't touch somebody else's tongue a little bit when he stuck that shit in their mouth? Now you're going to put his finger in my mouth? So the universe was universing. But I was quite bothered at the fact that, you know, I didn't open my mouth up, right, and hoping that, you know, he don't touch my you dig? And he going to come to me, and when I open my mouth, he gesturing with the thing towards my hand. So here's me in the Catholic. What the fuck? You ain't gonna put it in my mouth? Well, she nudging me like, no. And so I thought about it. Yo, you know, you was bitching about not wanting him to touch your mouth or whatever. So I just took it out of his hand or whatever. But I looked at his ass. You know, they all keep their eyes closed and shit. Now, fuck that. I want to look at you. Yeah, what the fuck? You ain't gonna put it in my mouth? I know, horrible. Absolutely horrible, right? Next time I went, you know, they didn't do the whole body of Christ thing or whatever. And I was like, are we all supposed to sip out the same cup? Because that's fucking nasty. Like, that's disgusting. I don't know. But anyway, yeah, that ain't for me. So anyway, you know, I went being nice. But yeah, that ain't for me. It's creepy. It's the thing, it just reminded me of every scary movie I had ever seen. I ended up feeling some type of way. I was ready to damn go. So yeah, but that's purgatory. And so I didn't get, you know, too much into Catholicism. You know, I was just like, yeah, nah, let me find something else. So I don't know. So Tracy said, Basaki and mother, other faiths don't practice that. I thought that's what I'm saying. Well, I mean, you know, they don't use the same word, but you know, I say that in Buddhism, depending on which sect of Buddhism, you know, you practice, there is a space called Ku or Kuanganjo. And that space is kind of where you hang in limbo before you come here and once you go. And so it's kind of like, you know, the space where you decide whether or not to take another body, come back to this big blue marble and try it all over again. You know, hopefully you have cleaned up enough of your shit that you'll have a much better life the next go round. But everybody doesn't believe, you know, in that. And then for those that are Christian, it is the space where you go to before you are found whether or not you're going to go and, you know, somebody say, you know, all your shit is wiped away, going on in, or you was fucked up and they pushed a button and you dropped down through the clouds into hell, wherever the fuck that is. So that part. But that's just me saying that. Don't pay no attention to me. I am not a theology student, because I'm the person that sat in Sunday school and was like, but if Jesus hung with the pimps and the hoes, like, was he a customer? And they were like, shh, don't say nothing. Listen, I'm asking. Are we not allowed to ask? So, yeah, I'm just trying to, you know, I'm not that person. They don't really want you to ask, even though they say, does anybody have any questions? Right, so Tracy said, exactly. They pray to the saints and Mary, and the Bible says that's a sin because that's reverencing man. Well, see, that's what I'm saying. But I mean, I always thought that they prayed to the saints were not actually saints. Well, they were people that had been so godlike, Jesus-like, whatever, that they had ascended from their mortal beings. But my thing was, Mary, why are y'all praying to her? Because she gave birth to Jesus? So then, should we not have been screaming at the presence of Michael Jackson and screaming at the presence of his mother? Because, like, greatness, are we, like, doing mothers now? Like, I try to put it, my thing is, why is the mom so important that a whole faith is built and based on showing her reverence? But anyway, we done got way far away from what we supposed to be talking about. So happy all day. Well, her happy all day ass said, a lot of black churches talk about going before the throne of judgment. Well, see, that's my thing. Like, see, it just, to me, I don't understand. I try to understand all of the stuff. You know, I've asked questions. I've done a little bit of studying because I was looking for something else. Because like I said, child, listen, I called and I was put on hold. Not even put on hold, child. He didn't even click over. He was on another call. So yes, I was like, I have questions and nobody's here to give me an answer. So I'ma just, you know, yeah, I'ma bounce. I ain't gonna stick around because things were happening and I needed some understanding. And my grandma would always say, and all you get an understanding. I'm like, well, don't somebody have to pick up the phone and explain some shit to me? I'm supposed to get some understanding, grandma, if nobody answers the phone. Right. Because you said he on the main line, I'm supposed to be able to tell him what I want. I want understanding. And he ain't even click over. So somebody talking too long. I need him to get off with them, wrap it up, and get over here. Because, yeah, I'm 12 and confused, and he need to click over. That's kind of where I was with it. And so that didn't happen. So I was like, yep, I ain't going back. Thanks. It's been a slice. I'm out. Mm-hmm. My grandma had already told me I was hellbound because I took I took my $5, child, and put it in the damn church plate and took four singles out. And she was like, girl, I told you to put that in the church plate. I was like, shoot, I still got Doritos and Mars bars tonight. What? I'm supposed to give it all? I'm like, but if God is God, he don't need my money. What? I'm supposed to give it all? Yeah, no, man. I took four singles back. She gonna tell them, bring that plate back around here. Suck it. Put that money in there. Put another dollar in there. I'll hit y'all up next time. Child and sister was looking at me like, is this little baby counting out four singles? Show this. Yep, I know how to make change for a five. Shit, I know you lie. I'm 8. I'm not dumb. The fuck? Yeah, right. So, yeah. Mm-mm. So, Alexa said, non-Catholic Christians, Protestants, Pentecostals, Baptists, don't believe in purgatory. Once you die, you either go to heaven or bust tail wide up. Child, listen. Well, I guess I must be a disruptor because, child, I don't know nothing about none of it. I'm, like I said, I do what feels good to me. Not like winter, but you know what I'm saying. I deal with it when it happens. Whatever. When I get to that point, I'll come back and let you. I'll come back and let y'all know. But in the meantime and in between time, I'm spiritual, whatever that means, child. I meditate, I pray, I chant. I do whatever feels good. I'll bow and prostrate if that's what I need to do. If I need to prostrate, then that is what I would do. I used to do that with my husband, not 5 times a day, child. Listen. You know, yeah. I was like, so how do you know what time? And like, what if you're in the middle of something, you know, that you can't stop doing? He was like, listen. Stop making it difficult. It's like, I'm just, babe, I want to know. Cause like you said 5 times a day. Come on, man. You know, he was like, but you get up 2 hours in front of your altar. What's the difference? It's just busted up throughout the day. We got to do it, get it done, and get on with the day. Then we do it at night, get it done, and get on with the night. Like, I, you know, like all of this, it's like, He's like, okay. So, what if that's how it's felt about you? I got to do what I got to do for her. And then until tonight, I ain't going to do nothing. But then you go, oh, my God, in the middle of the day. Listen, that's why you do it and get it done. So you covered. You protected. No, that's not how any of that works, apparently. But it's all right. So mother said, Winter doesn't know because she was never taught. And that's why Diamond and her angels were coming for her. Winter just did not know. Listen, Winter had the opportunity to learn. She chose not to. She chose not to. And of course her mama and them didn't know. Okay, so Alexis said communion is different for Catholics and non-Catholic Christians, along with how Mary and the disciples are looked at. Yes, absolutely. But they all say, because listen, I can remember being 5 years old, and they said that the grape juice was the blood of Jesus. So my ignorant ass goes, why are we drinking Jesus' blood? And how did he have enough blood in his body for all of us to drink? Because we just did this last month on First Sunday. Like, how much blood is it? And how many churches where they do this every first Sunday? Like, how much blood did Jesus have? Right. So my mother would be like, sock it! Shut up, girl! Right. I needed to know. I had questions. Nobody wanted to give me the answer. See, that's why kids stop liking to go to church. Because nobody wants to answer the tough questions. So mother said, I am Baptist and taught about purgatory in my church. See, that's what I'm saying. It just depends. Clearly, it just depends. It absolutely depends. So Tracy Cake said, child, I guess growing up in the holiness churches, they teach us straight from the Bible. And yes, we are to study to show ourselves approved. Child, yes. We was in church all week long. All week long. And the girls were still fucking in the church basement. I know you lying. So Black Diamond said, the throne of judgment is the sapphire throne of God. Okay. Child, tell me something. So Alexa said, purgatory is taught in non-Catholic Christian churches, but usually it's portrayed in a negative light. You're supposed to make sure you are saved and sanctified before death, once your spirit leaves. Yes, but for those that are new to all of that, you still have your old ways. So you still have some cleansing and expiation of sins has to take place. And that is what purgatory is supposed to be, that kind of last stop type thing. So you actually have to because what if you didn't find out anything about church? Let's say you lived in the hood your whole fucking life, never went to the church, was never taught that you needed to be saved and sanctified before you died, and you didn't find out until the chaplain in the hospital came around. Like, they could, listen, I'll never forget being in the hospital and being startled awake by the chaplain. And so here's my ignorant ass. Am I dead? Right. Because what the fuck is your creepy ass doing here over my bed? Like, don't do that. You don't wake me up. If you come in the room and I'm asleep, leave me the fuck sleep. You wake me up and you standing there holding a Bible and shit. I'm thinking, oh, I done died. Child, listen. So anyway, they come around. So I'm thinking in terms of somebody being on their deathbed, right? You don't know about anything. You in the hospital. They tell you about this. So you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, right? You still got about 10 minutes left on the planet. There is no way for you to be saved and sanctified in that moment. You ain't been baptized. You know, whoever it is, male or female, the chaplain has said that little prayer that they pray over you or whatever. But child, that don't mean you saved and sanctified. You ain't done what it is to be saved and sanctified. You ain't, you know, made yourself right. You ain't prayed no prayer. None of that. So when you die, you got to have somewhere to go, because you probably, if you on that part, you got 5 or 10 minutes left. You go somewhere to finish doing what you done started, right? That's purgatory. That's kuan ganjo. That is whatever you want to call it. You know, the last stop before the drop. But I like that. It is whatever that space is before you are either told, yes, you can go in, or hell no, who the hell told you to come up here, get your ass over there. You know you about to drop down. You take elevator B for basement. That's where you going. You going to hell. Get your ass down there. Right. You get in elevator H for heaven. You going up to the top floor. So you got the top floor. So elevator H is for heaven. Elevator B is for burning in hell. That's it. Period. You got to have a spot where you make the choice. Because remember, even after you die, you still got that little bit of time to exercise free will. It's a whole lot of folks that know damn well they ain't got no business. Right. But they still going to try to get in elevator H and get your ass out of here. Right. You know damn well which way you going. So what you say, okay. So once your spirit leaves your body, it's a wrap. But you think, so you're basically saying that as soon as you die, your body leaves, your spirit leaves your body. I don't think that now. I don't know. I think you get a little more time. So Happy All Day said, that's the sad part in church. When you ask too many questions, you become a child. Listen, I was a disruptor. I had questions. Like, I know that it take a sperm and an egg to make a baby. So, how did Mary get pregnant? How'd that happen? Yeah. They told me it was an immaculate conception. I I have thoughts. Nobody wanted to hear them. So I said, all right. I got popped in the mouth for that one. They didn't want to hear what I thought. So I said, okay. I'm going to leave that alone. So Alexis said, 10% tithes. Offering is on top of tithes and another story. Child, listen. Let me tell you something. When you ate and you got a $5 bill, shit, they getting a dollar, right? Because, listen, the Lord know my heart. The Lord know I like Doritos and a Mars bar. The Lord knows that shit costs, okay? I'm giving you a dollar, right? Why I got to give up the hole you dig? So even 10%. But I'm watching people putting 20s, 10s, 100s. I'm thinking to myself, what the fuck was they doing all week? I was a good girl. My dollar is enough. Isn't this payment to get into heaven? That's what I thought. I'm watching other people put in 50 cents. I'm like, oh, damn, they didn't do nothing. Right. Clearly, they didn't do anything. If they're only putting 50 cents in there, because see, you don't think in your mind that grown people would be having, you know, some financial issues or whatever have you, and wouldn't have the money. You know, they put in what they could. And it doesn't matter the amount of the offering. It is the spirit in which you give. That's the whole point. But when you're eight, you don't understand shit about that. So I'm thinking, I was a good girl. I'm giving God a dollar. God knows I like Doritos. He also knows. Because when you're eight, I thought it was a he. I thought God was a he. Ain't no Doritos at home. Mama didn't buy no Doritos. I got to have my Doritos. I got to be up in church all day. I got to have something. Grandma said, we're going to go to church's chicken on the way home. Shit, that's a long fucking time because we still have, at the end of this service, a little break. That's when I'm going to go get my shit. And then we got to come back for the afternoon service, right? My grandma was on the usher board. Like, listen, I got to have my snack shit. Otherwise, no, I'm sorry. Yeah. So I put my dollar in there. And then I put another dollar in there because everybody watching. The fuck? I'm going to give you all my money now. Come on. So Mother said in some churches, the throne of judgment or the throne of grace is the altar. Okay. What you say? Don't your ass come back haunting me. I won't. So Alexis said, I asked too many questions in Sunday school at 5 years old, and the Sunday school teacher dimed me out to my mom. Right, that's what I'm saying. They will dime your ass out, yo. And they'll make it like you asking the question is a bad thing, and they tell your parents, and then your parents are embarrassed for having this unruly ass kid who don't even know how to act in church. Just like they act like you was in there, you know, cussing and acting a whole ass donkey. Oh, sister so-and-so told me what you did. You in there asking all them questions. It's a sin and a shame. What? I'm like, what? How is it? I asked a question. She said, do you have any questions? Well, I had a question. I don't understand how that's a bad thing. I could not understand that. So, family said Uncle Sam takes 33% or more. The church is only asking for 10. Listen, let me tell you something. I was 8. Uncle Sam wasn't getting shit for me, but he was taking it from the folks that was giving it to me. That wasn't none of my business, okay? Shit, I know you lying. Wait a minute. Yep. Yeah. Listen, I have questions. Like my grandma say, and my late father, too smart for your own damn good. Okay, well, listen, I have questions. Y'all the big people. Y'all supposed to have answers. I know you lying. Yeah, absolutely wrong for diamond you out. They should have been talking to you about it. So Alexa said, Catholics believe after the prayer, the communion turns into the literal body and blood of Christ. Other Christians believe it's a representation of the body and blood of Christ and narrative of the Last Supper. Well, let me tell you, was like, this is a piece of saltine crack. I know what crackers look like. My skin don't look like this. It's white people in here. Their skin don't look like this. This is a cracker. See the little hole in it? It's a cracker. And this tastes like Welch's grape juice. Right. That kid. I went from wanting to know how much blood Jesus had in his body to this tastes like Welch's grape juice. Like, the fuck? Hey, astute Queen B, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Child, listen. Don't even talk about it. Don't even talk about it. Don't talk about it, family. So Alexa said, girl, some of these mega churches ask for your W-2 as a requirement for membership. Girl, child, listen. You know what? You joking, but I'm so serious. Because they be like, yeah, we know what you do for a living. Unasked the 10%. Shit, I know you lying. Wait, pastor gonna get that 10% come hell or high water. Listen. And then be standing up there like Jimmy Swagger. Someone, I have sinned against thee, my brother. I think it is so not fair that his ass got to die instead of and Tammy Faye. But Jim Baker, rusty ass, still alive. Fuck out of here. No. No. He was trash. Absolute trash. The mega church is going to hell for that. Listen. But I do love to listen to Creflo Dollar and Joel Chicklets Osteen. I do. I like Joel. I do. I like Joel Osteen. You know, he get they both have very inspirational messages. You know what I'm saying? Listen, sometimes you take the meat and throw away the bone. That's it, period. They both give very inspirational. I even li listen to that little what's his name? The little Prince guy that come on afterwards. He the little Asian dude that like to wear the leather bomber jacket, child. He a little I can't think of his name. Is it Jimmy Prince, Joey Prince, Teddy Prince? Whatever the fuck it is, y'all know what I'm talking about. So, mother says some of these Sunday school teachers didn't know the answers to your question. That's what it was, mother. That's what it was. Why you bullshitting? They didn't know the answer. So listen, I'm gonna where she said, had they asked for W-2, I would have done a military about face and marched right out of that church. I know, right? Pastor Cashflow, Creflo, another guy. I like him though. Listen, he preaches prosperity. Listen, he said, wealth is your birthright, is it not? You supposed to, you know, you're supposed to prosper. You ain't supposed to be broke, are you? You know, you ain't supposed to be broke, child. What's the point? I think back in the day, most people didn't really pay attention to that type of stuff and what was going on or whatever. But yeah, you know, you gotta do what you gotta do. You got to understand where you're at. So family said, Someone asked my pastor, should the 10% be off the gross or the net pay? My pastor said it depends on whether you want a gross blessing or a net blessing. Child, listen. My goodness. So here's my thing. Listen, you ain't finna charge me no 10% of what I earned, but not what I brought. No, I'm sorry, sir. You can go to hell, Pastor. Mm-mm. No. You rocking a bus pass and Pastor pushing a Bentley. I know you lying. No, ma'am. I'm not doing that. So anyway, listen. I'm about to, I don't know what this other thing is up here, but there is some other weird thing. Oh, I see it now. Okay, I got you. I'm going to get out of here, y'all. And this has been a slice. I was going to come back and tell y'all about the conversation that I had, but I think what I'm going to do, since you like him, I'm going to behave. I've been in the church world too long and know too. Me too. No man is perfect. No man is perfect. Good night, Foxy Woxy. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you showing up. I think what I'm going to do, y'all, is in the daytime tomorrow, I'll come back. I don't know. It depends on how I feel. It's only 9:30, but and nobody has to go to work tomorrow. I may decide to come back maybe in like a half an hour, 45 minutes. I don't know. If y'all still woke and y'all see the thumbnail and come in, we'll chop it up a little bit. But if not, well, then I guess we won't. So yeah, y'all can look for the thumbnail. It depends on how I feel, you know, but I'll either come back or I won't. How about that? If you follow me on the Instagram, you'll see whether I'm coming back or not. I'll have to remember to put it out there though. But yeah, y'all know what to do. All right. I love y'all. This was fun. I'm glad we didn't have to do this and end up coming back to talk about it and something else. So I'll let y'all know how I feel. I literally did not go to bed last night and I'm super tired. So that part too. So yes, I love y'all. Thank y'all for hanging out with me and I will talk to y'all later. Please, if you do nothing else, salute your spirit and protect your peace. Bye y'all.